Good afternoon. Welcome to the Durham Planning Commission. The members of the Durham Planning Commission have been appointed by the City Council and the County Board of Commissioners as an advisory board to the elected officials. You should know that the elected officials have the final say on any issue before us tonight. If you wish to speak on an agenda item tonight, please go to the table to my left and sign up to speak. For those of you who wish to speak, please state your name and your address clearly when you come to the podium. Please speak clearly and into the microphone. Each side, those speaking in favor of an item and those speaking in opposition to an item, will have 10 minutes to present for each side. The time will be divided among all persons wishing to speak. Finally, all motions are stated in the affirmative, so if a motion fails or ties, the recommendation is for denial. Thank you. Can I have the roll call, please?
Mr. Alter? Present. Mr. Bryan?
Present.
Mr. Busby?
Present.
Ms. Freeman?
Present.
Mr. Ghosh?
Present.
Mr. Gibbs?
Present.
Mr. Harris?
Present.
Mr. Hornbuckle? Ms. Hyman?
Present.
Mr. Johnson?
Present.
Mr. Kinchin?
Present.
Mr. Miller?
Present.
Mr. Van? Mr. Whitley?
To the agenda.
Staff has no adjustments to request tonight.
Thank you. The next item I have is the approval of the minutes for November 1st, 2016. I do have two corrections that I need to make before we get to the approval process. I have two individuals that are listed as unexcused absences. I do want to report that both of those individuals had provided some advance information, so I'm going to need a motion from this panel to excuse absences first for Andre Van on November 1st and for Commissioner Melvin Whitley on November 1st.
So moved.
Second.
It has been moved and properly second that we grant excuse absences for Commissioner Andre Van and for Commissioner Melvin Whitley for the November 1st meeting. All in favor of? Yes, I'm sorry, Mr. Miller did second. So all in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? And so we can enter those as excused absences. I do have one other thing that under Hyman, even though 30 extensions would be nice, it's a 30-day extension. Thank you. Are there other corrections to the minutes? The chair recognizes Commissioner Ghosh.
My name is spelled wrong, that's all. It's got an E in it, which it actually doesn't.
Are there other corrections to the minutes? Hearing none. Wait a minute. Commissioner Bryan?
No, I was just going to make a motion that we approve the minutes as amended plus the attached consistency statements.
Second.
Motion by Commissioner Bryan, second by Commissioner Busby, that the minutes be approved with corrections and the consistency statement. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by raising your right hand. All opposed? Thank you. The next item we have, public hearing. The first item, Creekside Commons, case number Z160001. Can we have our staff report, please?
Good evening, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. This case was continued in your last meeting in November. to give the applicant time to address some concerns from the residents and the Planning Commission. There have been two changes since previously, and since the previous time that you saw it, and I will go over those in my presentation. The applicant for this project is still Stephen Freeman. It is still located within the city's jurisdiction. It is still a request from residential suburban, but the new density that they're proposing is a planned development residential 5.0. It was previously a 6.302. The acreage is 26.461 acres, and the proposal is now for 132 townhome for 132 townhomes is what they're proposing, and it was previously 169 units. As stated, this is consistent with the PDR requirements for the zoning district with an acreage of 26.461 acres, the density of five dwelling units per acre, maximum height of 42 feet, and impervious surface maximum of 30.4. This was originally 30% on the last revision. This project is still consistent with the future land use map and the adopted plans and policies shown on this slide and in your staff report. And staff still determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies. Everything else remains the same as previously presented to you in the staff report reflects that. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
I do have two individuals who was four or against first. Okay. I do have two individuals who have signed up to speak for this case. Attorney Ken Spaulding, Durham, North Carolina, and George Stanzia. So we'll start with Mr. Spaulding.
Good afternoon, Madam Chairlady and members of the Planning Commission. My name is Ken Spaulding. I represent the applicant again in this matter. We're back in front of you after having a public hearing at the last meeting, and we requested a deferral at that time so that we could meet with the neighbors again. We also had heard from the Planning Commission, some of you members, that you felt that the 6.3 units an acre was sort of high density. And I think the one of the representatives of the neighborhood had indicated that they were comfortable, or he was comfortable with 5.0. We heard from the Planning Commission members that they sort of had a comfort with 5.0, and we were at 6.3. So we definitely felt we needed a deferral to meet back with the residents and to come back before you. We have done this, as staff has pointed out, we have met the our comprehensive plan, our policies and plans of the city of Durham. We also have worked very hard to try to come to a resolution as it relates to the residents in this commission. What we have done is that we have agreed, as you see from what staff had pointed out, to the 5-point units an acre. That took place after the developer met with the neighbors and the residents and discussed the pros and cons and certain issues that they wanted to talk about, which we addressed and have talked to and done the best that we could. Whether it meets all of the requests of everyone, that remains to be seen. The most important part that we worked on, and the developer went back and got with his people to see if it was at all possible to maintain a viable project and development by being able to reduce it to 5.5, 5.4, or 5.0. And they heard you loud and clear, and they heard what the representative had indicated, a request of 5.0, and we have done 5.0 units per acre. That dropped it down from 6.3 units to 5.0. from 169 townhomes to 132 townhomes. That reduced both traffic, school students, And so we have really, really, I mean really worked hard to try to address the concerns of residents and of this planning commission. So we very much would appreciate your support. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Stansel.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the commission. George Stanzial, 115 Cofield Circle, president of Stewart. The only other thing that I wanted to do tonight was to add a committed element that we have made staff aware of, and that is to commit to townhomes. Now, this has a big impact on the traffic, and so I know that Transportation Department is available to give you the new numbers, but we are committing to townhomes only at 5.0 units per acre. Thank you.
Thank you. I have two other individuals who have signed up to speak for. I have Ella Woods. Ella Woods and Isaac Woods.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Isaac Woods. I reside at 5223 Efficient Church Road. That is the property that is adjacent to this development. We share property lines. We have seen this area grow tremendously, but one thing I can say about this developer is they have reached out to the neighbors to satisfy all the needs and have communicated with us. And it would be a shame for us not to let a developer set this high standard where they've compromised, they've added things, and really they've offered to add other amenities if they could get it up above 5.0. But this neighborhood is a nice neighborhood. My family have lived in this neighborhood since the 1800s. My great-grandfather purchased this land adjacent to it. We own about 20 acres adjacent to this property. If you're familiar with it, we go all the way down from Creekside Elementary School, Burnton Road, and back to 40. And we've been looking for a developer that's sensitive to our issues in regards to the traffic, the amenities, the paths, the walkways that we need in this neighborhood. And I have not seen all my life in Durham a developer come before you and reach out to the neighborhood to bring amenities to a neighbor that's adjacent to this property. We didn't get that when they built Creekside. We didn't get that when they built the other subdivisions over Creekside. So I ask you to consider that when my great-grandfather purchased this from slavery after he was released, but you could think about that he would definitely be pleased for you to consider that this day and time that we have developers that adjacent to the property can reach out and say, look, let's be a good neighbor. What do you need? And they've been demonstrated here tonight where they went from 6.3 to 5.0, and there are some other amenities that you don't know about that they've added in there. But we need to reach out to this developer and set a standard here for the city of Durham that this is how developers work in Durham. And I ask you to please vote for this project and approve it. Thank you for your
time.
Thank
you. Are you also speaking for Ella Woods?
Ella Woods is my mother. Let me have her.
Okay.
Good evening to everyone. My name is Ella Woods, and I live at 5223 Ephes Church Road, Durham, North Carolina, 27707. I have lived there in a house that was built in 1964 up until this time. I'm still living there. I was born in a house on the corner of Burnton Road and Ephes Church Road. I was born there. So I have lived 84 years on the property adjoining to the property that's in question. And I can't see where it would harm anybody. They let everybody else, developers, put what they want to up. And they skipped over us two or three times with no water and with no sewer. The only reason we have water is because they had to bring it by my house. Not because they wanted to, but because they had to, because the line from Pope Road wasn't big enough, so they had to bring it from 40. And I live there, and nobody, no other developer that have built there in the last 20 years have came and tried to talk to us or tell us what's going on. A lot of times we didn't even know about the meetings at all. So we have water, but we don't have no sewer. And we'll be glad to support anybody that will help us put sewer there. We can't build on our land because it's they say it don't perk, but yet and still you can't get no sewer unless you got $5,000 or $6,000 to put into it to have it run there. And nobody, no developer in none of those areas have come and talked to us. They look at us as if we shouldn't be there. And I'm for the Rhine Company to have 6.3 units per acre, and the 5 point is over, because in the other meetings it have always been 6.3, so why can't we let them have 6.3? I'm going to be affected by it more than anybody else, so people that live two blocks, a half a mile away, is complaining about the traffic. There's other roads you could take besides coming through on Ephesus Church Road, but you won't come through there because it's easy way. And I live there, so I am for the Ryan homes, townhomes to be built. 6.3 units per acre. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Now I have a number of individuals who have signed up to speak against. Michael Cutlip, and I'll call three. Ted Szczynski, and Adam Jury. So we'll start with Michael Cutlip. Let's see, one. That's it. One more. Fourth one. Okay.
Madam Chair, I'm Michael Cutlip. We actually have a prepared presentation, and Ted Szczynski was planning to do the first piece. Is that all right with you?
Okay, I'm going to have to divide.
Piece. I'm sorry, Adam Jury will be doing the first
okay,
piece.
Okay, I'm going to have to divide the 10 minutes among all of the speakers, and if I
correct.
Need to extend it, right now there's also Brian Darden, so I want to make sure. No, that's okay. Then this is fine. Then we can, I think we've got 4 minutes.
Well, and, Madam Chair, just for clarification, so we have three total speakers against. I think we're trying
Let
to figure out.
Sure. Michael Cutler, two.
So
three.
They three total.
Three.
For 10 minutes.
Three total for okay. 10 minutes.
So promise it won't take that long.
Okay.
Is that showing correctly? Okay.
All right, so thank you. My name is Adam Jury. I live at 3 Wesley Wood Drive in Weston Downs. And I'm here to start the discussion on behalf of our communities against the Creekside Commons rezoning. And last meeting, we had discussed about how 6.3 was triple the density of the existing communities around. It's all single family homes around the Creekside Commons rezoning tract. And that would triple the density. Comprehensive development plan and the UDO both cite that you should have consistent development across and consistent character across the community, and this would not be consistent with the current area. So that was one of the main issues that we had. Now the developer has come back, and today we've learned that they've come down to 5. So we greatly appreciate that, and we still feel there are some issues that we have learned since the last meeting, and also there are some issues that I don't believe they're fully addressing with regards to also the traffic and that they're going to be creating out of this development and the school overcrowding issues. With regards to the school overcrowding, so last time we talked about how Durham evaluates everything on a system-wide capacity level, and right now Creekside enrollment is over 900 students. Currently the capacity is at 764 approximately per the Lee Village study that was done on behalf of Durham County. The school policy prohibits walking across the street without any kind of guardian for the kids, and right now one of our big issues is that the crossing of Ephesus Church Road by the students is really dangerous. There are cars, especially in the morning time, because school starts right at rush hour, and you have kids crossing there, you have parents trying to block traffic. It's really dangerous, and this development only adds to that, and we would like some more consideration put into how to deal with that traffic. And although the density has come down, there have been considerations in other developments for traffic studies or perhaps a traffic light, and that is something that we would very much appreciate Ryan to investigate. Now, the other issue is that Creekside is over capacity, and the UDO cites that basically the mobile classrooms, which they currently have, cannot match the quality of education that a full facility can allow students to have. And right now there's still no plan for another school that I'm aware of to be built. And all these kids, Weston Downs was built and the other communities around, and that they're very close to Creekside, so that's very attractive for families. And so although there's a minimal amount of students that are supposed to be added to the Creekside Elementary School by the development, I feel that this is probably understated because of the amount of kids that are coming already from Weston Downs. And so here you can see a picture of the trailers that the fifth grade has to go to school with every day.
Okay, thank you.
Ted Sozinski. I live in the Weston Downs subdivision at 5314 Weston Downs Drive. I'm going to review some of the pictures of traffic and discuss that quickly here. The bulk of the traffic for Creekside Elementary comes from the south. The traffic comes up 54, makes a left turn onto Farrington Road, and then another left turn onto Ephesus Church, and they make a left turn into the parking lot there. And then coming back, reverse the procedure, and the congestion is just incredible. Coming back, you may sit for 5 light cycles before having to turn left onto 54 from Farrington Road. And the car's waiting to drop off students at the Creekside frequently backs up the entire length of the entrance drive into Ephesus Church. First picture is northbound on Farrington, a little ways from 54. You can see at that point it's backed up. Continuing a little farther up towards Epheson Church, more congestion. Looking in the opposite direction, this is congested when kids, the vehicles leave after dropping off students. That's 54 up there. Another picture similar. Now looking in the opposite direction at that same location, you can see all the vehicles coming from Ephesus Church. Now we have some pictures at the school itself, looking towards Farrington Road along Ephesus Church. You can see the stoplight in the background from Farrington and all the traffic approaching the school and trying to turn left, and vehicles going out, some of them trying to turn left. And this is the exact intersection where the subdivision is going to go, directly across. And we're very concerned about this situation. Looking the opposite direction towards Creekside, again, there's the congestion, people trying to turn left into the school. Okay, that's my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Madam Chair, members of the Planning Commission. My name is Michael Cutlip. I live at 9 Tea House Court. And I'm going to talk a little bit about some additional complications of the possible increase in traffic. So the primary entrance to the development is going to be the same as the primary entrance to Creekside Elementary, which is the largest elementary school in both Durham and Orange County at approximately 900 students. As Ted showed in a slide just a moment ago, the entrance and exit of Creekside is very, very challenging around rush hour times and during the afternoon. So this is an overhead view of where that intersection is going to be. That primary turn from going into Creekside is coming from 40 from Farrington Road. And of course, the primary entrance and exit to the development is going to be right there as well. I would anticipate that the majority of people leaving the development would be going to 40, going to work, as are the majority of the parents leaving Creekside. So they're all competing for that thoroughfare down Ephesus Church to go down to Farrington. So of course, anyone turning left out of the development would be competing with this exact same congestion. All right. One of the things that we noticed looking at the application was that the current traffic assumptions for the property are based on the maximum possible development currently under the current zoning, which is 33 single family homes, which based on about 11 trips per day of 360-370 roughly estimated trips. Currently, there are only two homes on the property, which means that the actual impact is going to be far higher than is stated in the application. So the application estimates a proposed impact of an additional 636 vehicle trips. Since there's actually only two homes on that entire part, on all of those parcels, the actual impact would be far higher, at around 900. Increase on traffic on Ephesus Church. So the last traffic study that was done was in 2013. Weston Downs, which is the large adjacent neighborhood, was completed in 2013. So depending on when that traffic study was done, all of the traffic from the roughly 78 homes in Weston Downs may not be included in that. So that could be an additional 860 trips per day already above what that traffic study is telling you. So there's the current capacity you see for Farrington Road and Ephesus Church as pulled from the developer's application, and the latest source for that's the 2013 Department of Transportation count. So of course, one of our biggest concerns is pedestrian safety. And how do we ensure the pedestrian safety to and from Creekside Elementary? The developer proposed a crosswalk at the main entrance, but the main entrance is not where the predominance of pedestrian traffic is found. All of the students walking to and from Creekside predominantly cross at the intersection of George King Road, Weston Downs Road on the other side, and Ephesus Church. The primary vehicle crossing is what you saw in that picture, the exit to Creekside Elementary, and where the primary entrance to the development would be. Now, Ryan Holmes has addressed many of these concerns. The density is great. We have possible water management concerns, but we look to you, the Planning Commission, to help us negotiate the traffic and the pedestrian concerns. We're merely the residents that live there. Thank you.
Thank you. I have no other individuals who are signed up to speak on this particular issue. So I'm going to close the public hearing and now give our commissioners an opportunity to ask questions. Do I have commissioners who would like to speak? I'll start to my right. Commissioner Ghosh. Commissioner Johnson. Commissioner Busby. Okay. And to my left, Commissioner Gibbs. Commissioner Miller. Okay. You sure? Okay, and Commissioner Alturk. Madam Clerk, before we get started, I want the record to reflect that Commissioner Freeman is present. Did she? I'm sorry, because it's like when I look back, I did not see you, and then I got it. Thank you. Okay. Let's start with Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. First, I want to say thank you both to the developer and for the neighbors for their presentations. It was a very thoughtful presentation from the adjacent property owners. I do want to say that I appreciate the decrease in density to 5.0. I think that shows an ability to compromise, and ultimately I think that it's probably a better project than what was originally submitted, and if this process is helpful in making better projects, then I'm glad you guys are taking every opportunity to make use of the process. I did want to address some of the things that were brought up by you all in the back there. So one thing I did notice, and I don't think this is your fault at all, but in the staff report, the assumption for the max use of the existing zoning was based off of 33 single-family lots, and that was based evidently off of RR zoning. My understanding is that those parcels are actually zoned RS20, and so under the current zoning, I think you could get more like 58 lots than the 33 that is listed there. And actually, every other chart in the staff report, it does mention the RS20. So I think that's correct, and I think 58 single-family homes is probably what's there. So I think actually what's stated in the staff report for road impacts is accidentally overstated. Now, I do appreciate your point, which was that there's only two existing homes there currently. But unfortunately, I don't find much value in that, just because what we're talking about is reusing this property in some way, redeveloping it. And so to me, I think the more appropriate, the more appropriate data point to look at is what you could put there under the current zoning. And so, I mean, there's no doubt though. I mean, your point is well taken. The proposed development will add traffic to the road network. No doubt about it. I will say that, and I think it was stated that Ephesus, or the Creekside Elementary, is the largest elementary school at 900 students. I appreciate that in Durham we do look at a system-wide approach, and I think one of the reasons we do that is because we bus students to different schools, and I actually appreciate that. I think it's an important topic, actually, because there are other places in the country where they have neighborhood schools, and that can oftentimes result in inequity. I mean, so the fact that when we look at these development plans or proposed developments, that we look at a system-wide capacity in the school, I think that makes sense, because we do spend a lot of funds on getting students to different schools across our city. And I went to Durham Public Schools my entire life, so I think they're great schools, and I'm glad that I was able to take a bus to a school that wasn't right next to me, but a school I wanted to go to nonetheless. So I think, I understand that there's a capacity issue at Creekside. I don't think that this development is going to make it even more over capacity. I think that the more likely scenario is that students will get bused to different schools, and I don't think that that is a tragedy. I think that's actually a good use of our school system. And as far as the traffic along, the pictures of the traffic along or in this area, there's no doubt that there's an existing traffic problem. And I appreciate that you don't want that problem to get worse. But I'm not sure what you would ask the developer to do. It seems like you want it to be better. I want it to be better too, but I don't know that it's fair to ask the developer to do that. And you know, their proposal to put a crosswalk at their entrance, I think that makes good sense. I understand that currently the kids cross at a different intersection, but that may be because there is no crosswalk for them to cross at another location. And perhaps it would make a better situation. I don't know that, but maybe it would be better if there were multiple crosswalks for the children to better disperse. So I appreciate all the issues that you've brought, and I will say I appreciate the work that the developers have done. And I hope that everyone can see that through this process, some compromise has been reached. And I think that's a good thing. I ultimately will support this project as it is presented today. I think it's a better project than when it came to us months ago. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Commissioner Johnson.
Thank you, Madam Chairwoman. So Commissioner Ghosh highlights some of the sentiments that I have here. One, I would like to thank the developer for actually going back based off the feedback that was provided both by members of the adjacent communities in previous meetings and just feedback from my peer council commission members here. As I listened to the concerns, particularly from the neighbors of the adjacent, that's adjacent to this property, the concerns are the same. And so I appreciate the density issue. I will say that, you know, with the 6.3 density that we were presented with last time, I was not comfortable with that. And I did hear that, you know, the 5.0, if we, the neighbor, some of the neighbors said that if we can get to 5.0, that's something that we could live with. So that happened, and now we're dealing with the other but, and that's the traffic and the school issue. And so, in echoing some of the points that Commissioner Ghosh noticed highlighted, I guess the question would be is like what is the ask from the developer to assuage the fact that right now the traffic is bad, the pictures show this, and the schools are crowded. And so based off the presentation that I hear tonight, it seems that since these issues are currently existing, that essentially no development at all would be supported because these issues persist. And in thinking about Durham and where we're going with, you know, it's a growing city, and we have to figure out how we're going to support this. I think the question is, how do we do it in a way where no one is going to get everything that they want, but there's a middle point where we can that everyone can get some of what they want. And the question is, well, what's happening? And I don't know if anyone has an answer. Is no plans are in the works. I heard regarding the school crowding issue with the trailers. So what is the path forward for that? Like if the developer decides to pull the application tonight because it's like, what's going to happen with the school crowding issue? Like, that's still a question that needs an answer, along with the traffic issues. And so I'm comfortable with supporting the project as presented tonight, because I think that the developer has tried to work with the neighboring communities, as I've heard from this seat. And the fact that the individual who was for this project stated that this is not something that has happened in this area before. It has value for me because when I look at this map, there has been development going on in this area, and there has obviously it was enough support for bricks and concrete to get in the ground. And so I just urge, you know, the neighboring and adjacent communities to continue to work to figure out how do you actually improve the traffic and the school crowding issues, because the developer can't build a new school. you know, the developer can't put new roads around this in the area here. That's beyond their scope of expertise and what they do. So I think that with this project coming into this particular area in Durham, that, you know, it is more consistent with, you know, what I would ideally be comfortable with based on what I've seen before. And with that, I just wanted to say thank you to both parties of the table for continuing to talk to each other and get to a point where it seems like this can actually be a viable project. So thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner L. Turk.
I won't go long because a lot of the points that I wanted to make have already been made by Commissioners Ghosh and Johnson. I do commend the developer for going down to 5 units per acre. That's something that I think a number of us last month mentioned. I think it's something that was brought up by a number of neighbors in the neighboring community, and so I do commend the developer for that. I understand that there are still traffic and school concerns. This is a really tough issue. I don't want to belittle the concern for traffic. I live on a very busy street in Durham, but part of why I like living there is because it's close to the amenities that I like, and you know, I think as Commissioner Johnson mentioned, you know, Durham is growing. It's a vibrant community, and I'm hesitant to make a decision against this proposal simply because of traffic. I think there are, especially Commissioner Johnson has mentioned, traffic is already a concern there, and the school overcrowding is a concern. And as I look at this PowerPoint presentation that was just presented, you know, the question I think is right: can this be addressed by the developer, or is this a city or DOT issue? And I think the answer to that is that we need to fight for more schools, better roadways, or you know, more. I'm hesitant to vote against this development. I do think that I commended last month the neighbors for coming with very specific demands of the developer. And now I have to commend the developer for actually addressing the main concern, I think, that was addressed by both neighbors and the commissioners, which was the density. So thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Busby.
Thank you, Mayor and Chairwoman. I would echo a lot of the comments that were previously made. I did want to hone in on one specific issue. Mr. Cutliffe, I think, was very eloquent in honing in at the very end and saying the remaining concern is around traffic and pedestrian safety. And I'm not going to get the intersection correct, but there was the one photo that really stuck with me, is where you have all the parents turning in. They're making a left turn off of Ephesus into the church. And you're going to have a lot of the new development will be trying to make a similar turn, and this sticks with me. This is a problem. This is the point that has me debating if this is going to be dealt with appropriately. Mr. Spalding, Mr. Stanziel, I don't know. I'd invite you to offer your comments as you're coming to the microphone. I'll say, I drop my children at school across town. You see people make a lot of bad decisions when they're running a minute or two late to work or to drop their kids at school. And people have been hit at my school this year because of pedestrian safety. We have an officer out directing traffic. And yet, as you start dealing with lots of traffic and you don't have enough traffic lights, that picture in that intersection leaves me deeply concerned about the safety of this development. Everything else, I think we've done a good job here. The developers, the neighborhood, you've all worked well together. This is how the process should work. But that intersection, that leaves me concerned because there clearly needs to be something else done there. That's just not going to work. Someone's going to get hurt.
Yeah. Commissioner Busby, that picture, I think, was shown the last time as well. And you're right, it had an impression, an impact on us. So we just didn't leave it there and ignore it. What we did, Robert went and spoke with, what's his position? I know it's Hugh Osteen, but what's his position at the school system? Well, anyway, he's big shot at the school system. What ended up happening was that Robert sat down with him. They discussed it. They looked at it. They knew what was involved. We made it very clear that that would be a problem not only for the existing neighbors now, but also for this project. And one of the things he pointed out, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think he was quite as aware of the imminent issue that exists out there now that he should have been, quite frankly. And Robert made him aware, and I think that what he had indicated was that they were going to take another look at this. We have indicated, and I'm going to say this because I think it's important. I'm a taxpayer too. And, you know, areas like this, they are safety concerns. And we have sheriffs and we have policemen that we pay taxes for, and they work extremely hard. And at certain hours of the day, in the morning and in the afternoon, the city officials know that these are unsafe situations all over Durham, not just there. And it is a responsibility, and we made it clear that we are going to stand up on behalf of our neighborhood and any other neighborhood in regard to raising this point, that we are asking our city officials and our county officials, because I see them over at Jordan making sure that Jordan is getting out okay. I see them over at this RTI high school or our Research Triangle High School blocking us up when we're trying to drive too, to make sure that people can get in and out. And so what my understanding has been, and I think it's sad, that it's my understanding from Hugh Osteen that they charge the schools for this. Am I correct, Robert? They charge the schools for this. This is what we pay out, 3-hour minimum for half-hour work, Robert just said, but I don't know about all that. All I know is that we pay taxes. And in the morning and in the afternoon, if you know a robbery is getting ready to take place, you're going to have law enforcement there. It's unsafe. It's the same thing that our schools, all of our schools, should be able to have sheriffs or policemen there at a time when we know it is unsafe for our citizens. So this is something that I've mentioned and we talked about. We're not just going to sit still on it. We didn't when we saw that picture. You can see I'm a little riled up about it because, I mean, it's just not right. And they'll be there for a short period of time. And obviously, if there's a murder taking place somewhere or a robbery, then they might not be able to be there. But definitely the school system is for education. And they should not have to pay for the services that our law enforcement officers do. And this is not against the law enforcement officer. I'm a strong supporter of them. This has to do with our officials who make those decisions as to what's going to be needed there. And the school system should not be paying for this. So the bottom line is that, yes, it's an issue. Yes, it's one that's going to be addressed. It's one that we're going to help get addressed as well.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you,
Mr. Spaulding. And Commissioner Busby, was that?
That's helpful. If I may, we did this last month, and I think it was actually quite helpful to move this process toward a resolution. I'd like to invite one of the neighborhood representatives, if they're interested, to share what they believe would help address the remaining pedestrian and traffic issues. And Mr. Spaulding, thank you for your comments. I appreciate that. I also wish I was a big shot in my job title. Maybe I can aspire to that someday.
Thank you for inviting me back up to speak, Michael Cutlip. Like I said earlier, we're just the residents, we live there, we don't know what the best particular course of action is in this case. If it is a traffic study, if it is, you know, more review by someone on the Department of Transportation, if a light is needed there, if that's what alleviates it long term, okay, that's great. If it's a light at George King in Ephesus to stop traffic coming the other way, then maybe that's it. All of us are, I ran out of time, so I couldn't say this before, not opposed to development on that land. We know it's valuable. We want development there to be successful because it helps our property values as well. We don't want something to fail. We understand that. but those, you know, traffic and pedestrian concerns are still our lingering issues. And we don't have the data, we don't have the expertise to know what the right course of action is. That's why we look to you, the Planning Commission, to help us in that regard. And we also understand that the developer is going to be limited in what they can do and make commitments for. That's very, very clear, and we respect that. And we've been very, very pleased that Ryan Holmes has come to the table and worked with us so well and been able to make such compromises. But, you know, like I said, to your point, what would help us? An expertise opinion looking at that particular issue, not looking at what is, you know, just on paper based on historic traffic studies, but looking at the reality on the ground as it exists today.
Great, thank you. It sure strikes me, and I'm not an expert, but as you just said, it sure seems like we're going to need a traffic light at Ephesus Church and George King Road quickly. And that just is going to have to be dealt with if we want to make sure we actually have safe development in this area. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Busby. Commissioner Gibbs.
Well, I'm going to bring up a different point, traffic and school overcrowding. That's supposed to be funny. But there is my mic on?
It is.
It's on. Okay. I agree with all the comments so far, and I really do appreciate what Attorney Spaulding the points that he just made. And this development, it has taken this development, I think, to bring to light and expose what an issue is school system-wide. And I think this development, and I appreciate your reducing the density, these will become your neighbors. Not something to fear, but they will be, you'll find new friends. And when they move in, they're going to be moving in into the same situations that you're experiencing now. So they become your allies. And the more people that can get together and put pressure, whatever it takes, and any official will help you in any way possible to go to the correct authorities, whether it's Department of Transportation, the city, and their traffic patterns, how the traffic patterns, stoplights and the crosswalks, how all those things can be rearranged to make a safe, walkable community from this area to the school. And I just think it's something that not only for this specific development, but it really is important. And if there are any people on the Board of Education, the county commissioners, city council, the staff can't do this, the developer can't do this, but I'm making a challenge to you all, these officials, to take a look overall. We can find ways to have bond issues for this, that, or the other, whether it's for transportation, which I am all for, mass transit. But there are important things, our everyday life and quality of life. But that's the gist of my point, and I thank you.
Commissioner Gibbs. Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have some issues that I want to go over very quickly. First one is a technical issue, and I'll ask George, this is for you. I'm just looking at your design commitments on your development plan, assuming that I've got the one that was in our packet. It's the most recent one. So looking at design commitment number one, I think you've got in changing things around there, you've got some grammar problems. You're missing a verb. It says all buildings will a maximum. So I'll let you catch up to me. because I want you to see
it. What page is that on?
So this is...
tax commitments.
Okay. It's on your design commitments. It's on the top page of your development plan.
Oh, on the development.
Over in the box on the bottom, down here, bottom left, right here.
Can I come in?
Yeah, sure.
This is all buildings will A.
Will be a maximum of 3 stories.
Right, okay. Hang on to that. More issues.
So the other thing that I notice is that if you take that literally, that means that you can have 1 2-car garage for the building. And I think what you're actually referring to is units, not buildings. Isn't that right?
All buildings will be a maximum of 3-story. All buildings will have 2-car garages.
Well, it doesn't say that.
All units will have 2-car garages.
Yeah, it doesn't say units. It says buildings. It seems to me that that needs to be rewritten to say what you mean, not what you've got there. Can you tell me right now how many units you'll have in a building? How long, what you call a strip in another commitment there? How big? How many units in a strip?
I'm sorry. 2 to 6 units per building.
Would you be willing to add, when you rewrite that design commitment, put that in there?
Sure.
Thanks. So that was the technical thing that I wanted to address. And then back to this traffic issue. And I appreciate that the developer wants to put a crosswalk at its major point of intersection or its connection with Ephesus Church Road. It does seem to me, though, that what we really need is an improved pedestrian crossing at the intersection of George King and Ephesus. And I note that at some probably distant point in the future, George King is going to change its nature. You guys have reserved right-of-way, which may actually make this go faster, because we're going to have a thoroughfare cutting across the middle of your property, and then ultimately that's going to connect to Farrington. And it seems to me if that facility gets built, that's going to change the traffic pattern fairly dramatically. That's still going to be a lot of in and out for the school, but it's going to give the people who live in your development another way to get in and out, especially the people who do not want to get tangled up in the school traffic every day. I was just talking with Mr. Judge from the city transportation department. He says it's on the plan, but it's not funded. So I don't know when that's going to occur. How difficult would it be to put a pedestrian-activated traffic light at the intersection of George King and Ephesus Church Road?
A traffic signal?
Yes.
Just for pedestrian or a complete traffic signal?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's something where the pedestrians could push a button and get across, stop the traffic for however long it takes kids to get across Ephesus Church Road.
I mean, we can't commit to doing a traffic signal because that has to be done through a warrant study.
I understand that.
So no, we cannot do that.
I'm going to ask Mr. Judge, if I may, Madam Chairman, whether or not, based upon his experience, the warrants might be present in this case for some sort of pedestrian safety measure, pedestrian-activated signal or light somewhere in there to help people get across that, to break the traffic and help kids get across.
Bill Judge with City of Durham Department of Transportation. Right now, since George King Road really only serves, I think, one other subdivision further to the south and then becomes a gravel road, there's probably not enough vehicular volume on George King Road or Weston Downs where would meet the warrants for a traffic signal. Whether or not there would be enough pedestrians crossing from Weston Downs to the school, I'm not aware of any such warrant study that's been looked at that would show that, but as Mr. Stanzio indicated, in order to install a traffic signal, whether for vehicles, pedestrians, or both, there are standards and warrants volume thresholds that would have to be met.
So, but based on your experience, do you think there's, or would a warrant study be rewarded with a light here?
My personal belief is that it probably would not be warranted. I'm fairly confident that the vehicular volume doesn't. And I think, as one of the other speakers mentioned, it was my understanding, at least for a while, that the school actually was trying to discourage children, because of the age, from walking to school unless accompanied by a parent or guardian. So unless there were a significant number of children that were walking to school and crossing, it's probably not going to meet that warrant either.
Thank you, Mr. Judge.
That's all I have.
Thank you. Do I have other commissioners who would like to speak? Commissioner Brine?
I'll be very brief. I consulted briefly with Mr. Judge during our discussion. I just want to look again at table E1 in the staff report. This is on page 10. If you do, and these are very rough calculations, the actual numbers may be a little different, but if you, by the present designation traffic generated, if you calculate based on an R20 zoning with 58 single family lots, the traffic volume is approximately 580. If you go by the proposed designation and use 132 townhomes, the traffic is approximately 819. So the new development really only adds approximately 239 trips per day. And I just thought those numbers might be of interest to everybody that's concerned about traffic.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown. Are there other commissioners who would like to speak? If so, I'm going to close the public hearing. And can I get a motion? Commissioner Brine?
Madam Chair, I will move that we recommend approval of the Creekside Commons Z160001 with the additional committed element that will be only townhomes.
Second.
Madam Chair, if I may. Before we vote, I would also like for the motion to include this most recent proffer to rewrite the design commitment. Excuse me. Design commitment number one to improve the grammar and to clarify the distinction between buildings and units, and to also include a commitment that the buildings will contain between two. Not fewer than two and not more than six units.
I accept that amendment.
Okay, I have a motion by Commissioner Brine and a second by Commissioner Whitley that we move item Z160001 forward with a favorable recommendation and design details as stated. All in favor of this motion, I'm going to ask for a roll call.
Mr. Al Turk?
Yes.
Mr. Brine?
Yes.
Mr. Busby?
Yes.
Ms. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Ghosh?
Yes.
Mr. Gibbs?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Kinchin?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Whitley? Motion carries 12-0.
Thank you. Our next item, public hearing for Village Hearth, item number Z1600014. Oh my God.
Good evening again, Kyle Taylor with the Planning Department. I can affirm that all legal notice requirements have been executed in accordance with state and local law, and affidavits for such are on file in the Planning Department. Zoning case Z1600014, Village Hearth, co-housing community. The applicant is Dan A. Jewell. It's in the city's jurisdiction. The request is from residential suburban 20 and residential suburban 10 to plan development residential 2.110. The acreage is 15.207 acres, and the proposed use is for 32 single family and multifamily units with community buildings. The site is located at 1000 Infinity Road in the suburban tier and the FJB Watershed Overlay Protection District. The site satisfies the criteria for the PDR zoning district as highlighted in this slide and in the staff report. The site is heavily wooded and there's currently a single family dwelling and several accessory structures located on this site. This project meets the requirements for a development plan for a PDR zoning district. The proposed conditions page commits to two access points that are shown, one of them being listed as a future connection. Location of building and parking envelope and general location of project for tree protection areas. The project does commit to 32 residential units, two access points, like I stated, one on Buttonbush Drive and one listed as a future street connection to the east. Impervious surface maximum of 24% or 3.649 acres. Tree coverage of 20% or 3.041 acres. Graphically commits to location of tree preservation areas, location of access points, and building and parking envelope. There are two text amendments proffered with this. The first one being that prior to the issuance of a building permit, dedicate 15 feet of additional right-of-way for the frontage of the site along Infinity Road. A copy of the recorded plat must be submitted with the first building permit application. And secondly, all non-building area will be common open space. There are a number of design commitments associated with this, namely being that a commitment to the type and style, and each building will utilize a minimum of two of the following building materials: brick, masonry, mason block, stone, metal, stucco, artificial stucco, vinyl, or cemented siding materials and trim. This request is consistent with the future land use map, which designates this area as low density residential, four dwelling units per acre or less. Staff has determined that the proposal is consistent with the comprehensive plan and policies outlined in this slide and in staff report. And staff determines that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies. Thank you, and staff is available for any questions.
Okay, I have seven individuals who have signed up to speak for, so I'm going to need some additional time.
Madam Chair?
I have nine speaking against.
Madam Chair, if I may, given the large number of speakers signed up, both for and against, seven for and nine against, I would move that we allow 20 minutes per side.
Second.
Okay, it has been moved and properly second that we allow 20 minutes for both sides. All in favor of this motion, per side. It's 20 minutes per side. So all in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed, ayes have it. And now, Mr. Jewell, we can begin. We'll start with 20 minutes. We're gonna divide this time up among all seven.
Great, thank you, Madam Chair. And our speakers have not necessarily signed up in the order, but we will, as they get ready, they'll line up here so we can move ahead. So thank you for your indulgence on that. Good evening, commissioners. My name is Dan Jewell. I'm a landscape architect with Coulter Jewell Timms. We're just down the street at 111 West Main, and I reside at 1025 Gloria Avenue. The members of the Village Hearth co-housing community have asked our firm to help them bring their vision of a co-housing community to fruition by assisting them with this zoning application, the site design, which will happen in the near future, and the permitting that goes along with all that. Kyle with staff has described the location and generally outlined our proposal well. There are a series of speakers that will follow me who can explain much more eloquently than myself what co-housing is all about, why some of them are choosing to live in this community, and how they've worked to engage the neighbors in a positive way, they thought. What I'd like to do is give you a bit of information about what we are proposing to do and what we are not proposing to do. We are proposing to develop a community of up to 32 units. By our calculations, this is an exactly equivalent density than the current zoning would allow on this property. The community will be oriented around common open space, designed in such a way as to have much less impact on the land than a conventional subdivision would, with the goal of preserving as many of the specimen trees as possible. Just to let you know, sometime early next year, the community will get together and they'll engage upon a series of design workshops with their architect. I will be involved with that as well. And they will work on starting to design a site layout as I described, work on the building architecture, the style and mix of units that best works for the community as well as the individual needs of the residents. We'll also be preserving the stream corridor that's shown on our existing conditions and development plan and buffer that's on the northern portion of the site near Infinity Road. Most of all, our goal is to create a community which is sensitive to the land, the neighbors, and still preserves the appeal of the property which led them to purchase the property in the first place. Yes, they have already purchased this property. You all probably know that this is fairly unusual in our business. Generally, land is put under contract with a closing conditioned on a successful rezoning and quite often even a successful site plan approval. I think this reinforces the point that these folks are not developers. They are working to create an intentional community that they all will live in. What we are not proposing is a conventional single-family subdivision. The current zoning of the property, which is RS-20 and RS-10, the land is already appropriately zoned to do a single-family subdivision of the same number of units as we are proposing by right, with no rezoning, no public hearings, no required neighborhood meetings, or votes by you or the elected officials. It would simply be all administrative approvals. But instead, these folks willingly come to you asking for a rezoning to the same density simply so that they can cluster their houses in a way that creates this community with all the common open space that we're proposing. We are well aware that the neighborhood concern is about traffic and opening up the end of Button Bush. This is understandable. These neighbors have enjoyed a quiet little dead-end street for all the years that they have been there since their neighborhood was created many years ago. I also know this because my old partner, Ken Coulter, actually did the initial land planning for part of this property back in the 1970s for the Irvin Company before it changed hands several times and then a portion of it became Eno Trace. Our proposed connection to Button Bush will add cars to the end of this street, but not to the extent that I believe these neighbors fear. Folks who live in co-housing are traditionally older and drive much less than a typical household where one or two people will work and quite possibly have children who need to be carted to school or soccer practice or whatever. But in order to strengthen this argument and that commitment, the Village Hearth folks have instructed me to proffer tonight that there will be a committed element on the development plan. I discussed this with staff previously, that this will be an age-restricted community, 55 or older. I believe when you're ready to ask questions of staff, City Traffic Engineer Bill Judge can confirm for you that this will in fact mean a lower trip generation rate than a non-age-restricted community would, and especially a single-family subdivision. We're also very aware the question has arisen and is being asked time and time again, why we don't connect to Infinity Road as the primary entrance to this community. There are numerous reasons, including there's relatively poor sight distance on Infinity Road as you're traveling east to this driveway. There's a hill there if you've been out there. The previously mentioned environmentally sensitive stream that we don't want to further impact. The fact that the existing driveway culvert over that stream is failing and needs expensive repairs to be used for day-to-day traffic. We are currently proposing that it be kept open for emergency vehicles and maintenance. And my empirical history with NCDOT that any project that proposes a primary entrance on a DOT road, even of a very modest size like this, will precipitate the need for a left turn lane. And in my 35 years of experience in this business, left turn lanes are now running $300,000 and more, which would be a great burden on this community that's trying to create a space which is livable and affordable for them. For this and other reasons, including staff's finding of concurrence with the comprehensive plan and the other requirements, we would ask your recommendation for approval tonight. And I'd now like to hand the microphone over to Pat McCauley, who's one of the founders of Village Hearth. Pat.
Good evening, commissioners, staff, and neighbors. My name is Pat McCauley. I live at 749 9th Street, apartment 480, Durham 27705. I, along with other members of Village Hearth Co-Housing, am planning this senior co-housing community. We're looking forward to moving into our small quality cottages where we expect to live the rest of our lives. By creating this community, we can easily look out for each other, help each other with groceries and other tasks, all the while minimizing our trips into town. Because co-housing communities are self-developed, it's our money on the line. There's no deep-pocketed developer, nor hundreds of units over which to spread the considerable infrastructure costs. We're making every effort to keep our homes as affordable as possible for our members. After a six-month search last year, we found this affordable, beautifully wooded lot and closed on the property in August of 2015. Dan is providing a handout detailing our outreach to the neighbors. We immediately introduced ourselves by mail to our 23 adjoining neighbors and to Eno Trace's management company, indicating our intention to develop this land in line with existing zoning and to keep them informed as our project progressed. We received five responses, most curious about the type of development, and they were mostly relieved that we weren't building a big apartment building. Following Dan's submittal of our development plan in May 2016, we mailed invitations to 115 neighboring households to attend our June 28th voluntary information session, conveniently located at the North Durham Regional Library. Four neighborhood households attended. All were supportive of our community, but one household had serious reservations about our using Button Bush to access our homes. Word spread, and a total of eight additional Eno Trace neighbors sent emails welcoming us to the neighborhood, but requesting that we not access our property through the stub on Button Bush. Four households agreed to meet with us individually, with one household hearing and understanding our reasons for entering via the road that directly accesses the flattest part of the land where we plan to build our homes. We do recognize that change is hard for everyone, but development is an inevitable outcome of living in a really cool place like Durham. Village Hearth Co-Housing represents the best kind of development in this area possible. Instead of a multi-story apartment building, we're adding a small number of really friendly neighbors. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Alice Alexander. I live at 301 Hunt Street, very close to here. And I'm the executive director of the Co-Housing Association of the U.S. I'm also a happy resident of Durham Central Park Co-Housing Community on Hunt Street. It's just about a half a mile from here. I appreciate the opportunity to introduce you to the concept of co-housing. Cohousing communities are intentional, collaborative neighborhoods that combine extensive common facilities with private homes to create strong and successful housing developments. Most cohousing communities are organized as townhouse or condominium developments with a homeowners association as Village Hearth cohousing plans. Cohousing is a descriptive term that shows the intent of these developments to cultivate a strong sense of community through extensive common facilities and active collaboration of the residents. Cohousing communities are part of the new sharing economy and are predicted to expand rapidly in the next few decades as individuals and families seek to live more sustainably, and changing demographics force us to find innovative ways to address the roles traditionally played by extended families. Most cohousing communities are intergenerational, with both children and elders. In recent years, senior cohousing, such as Village Hearth, focused on older adult needs, have grown. The more than two decades that cohousing communities have existed in the U.S. have shown that these communities are strong financially, with very few foreclosures, even in the most troubled markets during the depression, during the recession, excuse me. The strong sense of community and mutual support they create actually reduces financial risk, making these communities even better investments. We have four cohousing communities in Durham, with two nearby in Chapel Hill and Carrboro. Nationally, there are 165 cohousing communities, with 130 in process. As a member of Durham Central Park Cohousing, I enjoy sharing Sunday night meals in our common dining room, weeknight happy hours, and spontaneous gatherings. When I need a ride to the airport for a 6 a.m. flight, it still amazes me that neighbors really do want to give me a ride. When a neighbor needs help after surgery, we all rally around to provide support. Jointly caring for our home, the gardens, the building facilities, has created a strong and vibrant community. Cohousing also facilitates community engagement, and most of us volunteer for community service. Our happiness and success has translated to 300 people on an interest list asking about openings. I've been impressed with and proud of the founding members creating Village Hearth and the development professionals they have engaged. Thank you for this opportunity to express my support for Village Hearth Cohousing.
Hello, my name is James Taylor. I live at 14 Hummingbird Lane, Durham, right there in Eno Trace. I built most of the houses there in Eno Trace now, 250 homes probably. My land backs up to this property, and I'd much rather see this type of community go in than 100, 105 unit townhomes. So I'm all for this project. Buttonbush was a dead end. I bought all my lots off of Alan Aldridge, and the goal always was to extend it through, but the elderly gentleman that owned the land just would not sell it. So that dead end street was always meant to go through.
Good evening, my name is Paul J. Stinson. I live at 1006 Gloria Avenue in Durham. I am a member of Village Hearth Cohousing, and I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you more about our proposed community. Cohousing is a form of an intentional community where people agree to be good neighbors and good stewards of the earth. Senior cohousing takes the idea further by including smart universal design features to aid in accessibility. It's a wonderful situation for age in place. We're planning to build up to 32 single-story cottages in close proximity, resulting in homes clustered near a clubhouse, to further construction savings as well as future construction savings as well as future energy savings. We're planning to attach our homes in duplexes, triplexes, or quads as they fit on the available land. Building on the flattest part of the land will keep our paths accessible for seniors with cranky knees, which mine are already starting, by the way. Our rezoning request is not to increase residential density, rather to accommodate clustering and attaching the homes. In fact, by building only 32 homes, we'll have much less impact on the land compared to a typical developer. That we are not going in clear cutting, anything like that. We actually like the trees and we like keeping it the way it is. That's why we're there. Part of the process of creating cohousing is the participatory nature of the design process, We're looking forward to going through that design process so we can see how our new homes will look and where everything will be located on our land. Another feature typical to co-housing is living lighter on the land, so clustering our homes helps us preserve a large amount of green space where we can have gardens and space in which to enjoy our wooded land. Most folks will only have one car, and we understand there's a possibility of us getting confused about which Prius belongs to whom. But probably won't be a lot of driving after dark, but that's to be seen. We know one of our senior co-housing communities where members formed an LLC and leased an electric car to share among the six participants. So there's many options there. It's a natural outcome of living in close proximity to one's neighbors that rides be shared and items picked up for one another, thus reducing expected traffic flow. I know I'm sure looking forward to all the benefits of co-housing can bring. On a last note, I'd like to say, I grew up on Ladder Road, which is just right across Rossboro Street. And I've lived in Durham most all my life. And one reason that I'm doing this is I would like to spend the last part of my life back there in Northern Durham where I'm from. Thank you very much for your considerations.
Thank you.
Madam Chair. There was a number of elements that gentleman just proposed forward that are not included in the development plan. We need a clarification of whether those are things that are actually being proposed at this time or not.
That would be Dan, because that was a resident.
Many of the things that Mr. Stinson described are design intent, but not yet committed elements. But I assume we will probably discuss that a little bit later.
Thank you. Now, Mr.
Good evening. My name is Jim Kimbrough. I live at 1102 Infinity Road, which is next door to the planned development. My wife is Judy Strickland, and we both support the co-housing development and sincerely appreciate the effort that's been made by Village Hearth to keep us in the information loop concerning this property, which has been vacant and unkempt for so long. As neighbors, we want to make sure that there is no degradation in how water runoff is handled, since a lot of water does travel through our property onto the Village Hearth property and eventually onto the Eno River. The tree coverage area that has been described in DP1 in the development plan needs to be updated. In late autumn, Duke Energy came through, had a contract to remove all the trees along the property line and some additional area between 1000 Infinity Road and the three neighbors to the east. On page 8 of the zoning map change report, the last section titled Long Range Bicycle Plan states that, quote, the additional asphalt widening will be provided to allow for a bicycle lane, end quote. Increasing the paved width of Infinity Road for only 200 feet has little utility as a bike lane. Our property line currently has a three-board fence along Infinity Road to control our livestock. Increasing the width of Infinity Road in front of our property would be too close to that fence, and also the additional impervious material will cause more water runoff along Infinity Road. Finally, on DP2, there is a notation for future street connection to the property of one of our neighbors, Joe and Ann Browning. The Browning property is served by a private driveway, which also serves several other properties along Infinity Road. Just that one designation will impair the value of the surrounding land area. Since none of the current neighboring landowners to the east agree to this designation, please remove that notation from any development plans. Summary, in order to minimize the effect of water runoff for the development, revise the tree coverage area and delete the notation for the bike lane. Also, remove the future street connection from any documents relating to this development. Thank you.
Mr. Christopher Ross.
Good evening. My name is Christopher Ross. I'm also a member of Village Hearth Co-Housing. I live at 1021 Fox Trail in South Boston, Virginia, and also at 925 Alabama Avenue here in Durham. Funnily enough, my partner and I cannot remember exactly when or how we heard about co-housing. But once we decided to sell our house in Southern Virginia and move to Durham, we began to explore the Triangle's several co-housing communities. What sold us on Village Hearth, you may ask? Several things, actually, starting with the opportunity to be in on the ground floor of this kind of community, thereby not only being able to take advantage of early member discounts, but more importantly, to have significant input into the physical design of the community. For example, what should we have in the clubhouse and where should the common house go? Where should the dog run be? Will there be a place for me to meditate out in nature? There are innumerable details to be worked out as we go forward, and we're eager to share our vision as the community takes shape. This way, the community adapts to us, to what our collective values are, to what our specific needs are as we age in place, and rather than our having to adapt to a pre-existing community, rather. Let's face it, we males hate to commit. But there comes a time in life when it is important not only to have neighbors, but to even know them, to be around people we care about and who care about us. And that extends beyond Village Hearth. Village Hearth, in other words, offers us men the seemingly paradoxical ability to be part of a community, to be committed to its success, and to be connected to the other residents, while also allowing us to be free and independent and autonomous. We will come and go as we please and participate in social activities that we are interested in and not in the ones that we are not interested in, but we're also free to lock ourselves away if so moved. My partner in his studio to paint, and I in my study to read, write, and meditate. Village Hearth will satisfy both of our needs in that my partner needs a green, peaceful, quiet place to live, and my need is access to the city to be on the town and out and about. Most importantly, Village Hearth will embrace us as we age in the unique way that a co-housing community is designed to do. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ross. That ends the individuals who are speaking for. I'm going to call at least four names so that we can at least be in the queue to save some time. We'll start with Joe Browning, Mary Ellen Lowry. Okay, thank you. Is this Kennedy Rizzito? Yeah, okay. So at least I have four. I only have two.
Hello, everyone. My name is Joe Browning. I live at 1116 Infinity Road, which borders the proposed development. My chief concern in the current submission of the plan is the fact that the future road access would in effect bisect my property that my wife and I have spent a considerable amount of money and time to improve. And I've spoken with both Mr. Jewell as well as the landowners, and neither of them want this road to go into place either, as well as you can imagine I do not. I would request that it be removed from the plan. One other note, the reason that the existing road frontage on Infinity Road for the proposed development can't be used as a failed culvert. My home and three other homes share a private driveway that also has a failed culvert. So to get to Infinity Road from my house, you would have to come down that private road. It would have to become public, and you're dealing with the same issue of a failed culvert that we're told Village Hearth can't use currently. So my request would be that the future road site be removed from the rezoning submission.
Thank you. Ms. Rizzita. And Andrew Claren, if you can go ahead and get in the queue, okay.
Good evening, Madam Chairman.
Good evening. My name is Kennedy Rizzuto. I'm at 4707 Buttonbush Drive in Durham. And as part of the announcement for the meeting, there was a map attached to the announcement. Do all the commissioners have a copy of that map? I don't know how to get it on the computer for you. Okay, thank you. I'll be referring to that. Commissioners, I invite you to come to Buttonbush and look at the things that I'm about to address. I have a family with three children. My husband is here. We have approximately on Buttonbush alone, those few hundred yards, 15 children. That does not include the grandparents who have children in the neighborhood that regularly visit. We have no public park there. There is absolutely no other place for our children to play in the open together except from street to street and yard to yard. The development and relationships that my children are building are critical for their future. By opening Buttonbush, you close those relationships. And I know that sounds extreme, but I've seen it day to day. Many of you have grown up on busy streets, Commissioner Alter, others of you. But this is not a busy street. This is where they play together. It's almost, I called it once, a flash mob of middle school boys showed up at my house. They descend upon Buttonbush. They see one kid playing, one kid bikes by, they come over. The girls are out there doing gymnastics. They're out there constantly running from house to house in the streets. They have those little, there's people constantly walking with strollers. We have newborn infants on our streets who are in the front packs, moms pushing the strollers, walking the dog. They take up half the street. One family or one mom walking with their strollers takes up half the street. So there's no room for more traffic. They need to keep the Infinity Road access open. I'm sorry, I thought we had 20 minutes for the group. I didn't realize. I'm sorry. Oh, I appreciate that. I'm new at this. Okay, I'm new.
So. I'm sorry, I don't have your name listed. Oh, are there two sheets? Because this is the only one that I have. Let me just take a look at the other sheet to make sure that I have. Okay, you're in a different column. I have it. It's in a different column. Thank you so much.
Okay. So this gentleman's 2.5 minutes.
Okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. So how much time do I have, please?
Just keep going. We'll.
Okay, thank you, Madam Commissioner. Thank you, Commissioners. The bottom line is that we were all really shocked that the plan was to close and access to the main road. We couldn't understand it, we couldn't believe it. And yes, Buttonbush was originally hoped to go through, but that person didn't sell, so it didn't. We can't have the Infinity access closed. Looking at your maps, the access from the 1000 Infinity property through the Eno Trace neighborhood is over half a mile. No speed bumps on Buttonbush, no sidewalks the entire way. There are speed bumps on Shadebush going all the way out. There are two actual turns. It goes by five bus stops, children standing out there in the dark, cars, parents parked, blocking half the streets. It is the curve at Buttonbush near the B, the capital B. You can't see around it. One of the families didn't even let their children up until last year go up to that corner because it's so dangerous. This is a dangerous route to take. It goes around that dangerous corner. You have to take a right, then a left, then over the speed bumps. And once you get to an infinity, it's almost a blind pullout. I don't know why they even put it there to begin with. But up to the left, there's a hill, so you can't see the cars coming except flying down that hill at you, trying to turn left. And to the right, the view is very limited by a hill also. I mean, it's a Hail Mary getting out of there. This is a very dangerous route to run through the neighborhood for them and for us. No sidewalks, no speed bumps on Buttonbush. Last summer, the paper ran an article about emergency vehicles trying to get into neighborhoods that far over speed bumps. They were saying it was a critical difference in life or death. The access to infinity that they currently have is safer, shorter, and smarter. Please let our children be children. Let our community, be a community. We don't have a place to meditate. Let our children be together. Thank you.
Thank you. Andrew.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. I live at 4804 Buttonbush. So,
state your name, please.
I'm sorry. This is Andrew Claren.
Okay.
And as stated, I live on the same street. I was going to bring up some points that they actually kind of touched on themselves. They almost kind of joked about how they're elderly and, you know, have issues driving. That's kind of some of the concerns that we have with the current street. Since most of the homes are older, a lot of them only have single car garages, so a lot of people do park on the street. There is street parking there, and when you get two cars parked on either side of the street, access down the road, even for normal pedestrians or people driving, you have to kind of weave around the cars. So I couldn't imagine emergency vehicles trying to come down that on a regular basis. I guess if the planned community wasn't going to be an elderly community, then you know that could be a concern that would be removed. But as stated, it's a shorter distance to keep the Infinity Road access than come down Buttonbush. The actual distance from the Lazy River access onto Infinity and the 1000 Infinity access that they currently have is 200 yards. So they're going to drive a half a mile to get to a property when the entrance to their property is 200 yards from the road they would be driving anyway. I think a lot of the things that we're concerned with is related to the traffic. We don't have any concerns with who's going to be building there. It's nothing personal. I will say that it was mentioned that they met with some of the homeowners. They mentioned numbers of how many people came out. We spoke amongst ourselves and realized that every time we met with them, it was the same kind of thing that was presented to us. The reason more people didn't meet with the developers is we realized we weren't going to get anywhere with them. So we were going to speak to the people that did have control over it. So there was no reason to meet with them anymore. One comment that was made when meeting with them, when asked why they didn't want to keep the Infinity Road exit, was that if they had that as an entrance, then we would use it as well. So they didn't want to have traffic flowing through their neighborhood, but they were okay with building through our neighborhood to maintain their sense of less traffic. The other thing I'll touch on is yes, they purchased the land, but if you don't have the money to develop it, then why move forward? Why would you purchase something not knowing if you can fully move forward with your plans? If widening Infinity was something that was going to come up, then they should have built that into their plan and not say that it's something they can't afford because they bought this land. They need to be able to develop the way that's the safest for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to call the names of the next five people. Carlos Cheek, Ben Anderson, Caroline Anderson, Chris Sheehan, and Darren Sheehan. Carlos Cheek will be first. Thank you.
Excuse me. My name is Carlos Cheek, and I live at 4812 Button Bush, which is directly adjoining the property in question. And I just want to say that, you know, when we moved into Eno Trace 10 years ago, we were looking to, you know, buy a house, coming from a townhouse. One of the things that intrigued us about Eno Trace was just the family-oriented atmosphere, and especially that street. Button Bush Drive is probably the most kid-friendly street in the whole neighborhood. And like Kennedy mentioned, you know, the street actually has a blind spot because of the curve. And we was just had, you know, normal people, like delivery trucks and things, come flying down the street, you know, which, you know, causes concern. So just to have that extra traffic, you know, in and out. And I know that, you know, the people from Village Harp say that, you know, the traffic may be minimal, but you don't know that really. And it's still going to be more than what we have right now. My daughter, you know, there's, like I said, it's just a really kid-friendly area. I mean, they get home from school, and at any point, there's 10 kids out in the street. Another thing that, you know, really concerns me, I don't know if everyone's been down to the end of Button Bush, but where that dead end is, there's a lot of really large boulders. So, you know, I'd be curious to hear from the developers, what's the plan as far as how are you going to make a road through there without removing those boulders? And if you need to remove them, what does that mean? Does that mean you need to come in and blast with dynamite? I mean, I work from home a lot. And, you know, I just need a little bit more information. It seems like when we were first presented with this idea, and I want to just say, you know, that everyone is happy that, you know, you want to bring the community in.
The Please speak issue, into think, the mic.
Okay. The biggest issue, I think, with everyone is just that entrance to the neighborhood. And another thing is, you know, is it going to be still listed as 1000 Infinity Road? If that's the case, if you got to, you know, give people directions to get to your house and they got to come through a whole nother neighborhood, that just doesn't make any sense to me when, like Andy says, you know, a mile and a half from the main road when you can just have that 200-yard entrance. So, I mean, that's pretty much my piece. I really honestly don't see any way that I can support this, regardless of any development changes. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Thank you, Mr. Cheek.
Good evening, Madam Chairwoman, Commissioners. My name is Benjamin Anderson. I live at 4330 Lazy River Drive in Durham, North Carolina. I'll just echo the concerns that have been already stated, but I do want to clarify my position in that I do agree that the co-housing concept is a good one. And I really think, and many others, I think, that have, you know, presented ideas in our community forums that we've had on this topic have also expressed that they do think the idea of it is very exciting and that the neighbors would be really great neighbors. It just comes down to this development point of the access through Button Bush. And echoing my neighbor's concerns, I too and my family have concerns regarding the traffic that would be generated. My concern more so the immediate traffic related to construction vehicles in the short term. Maybe the long-term traffic would not be as high of an impact, and I'm sure we'll hear about that. But this is a very heavily trafficked community. We don't have sidewalks that are developed throughout the community, so the access point of getting out in the community and walking is on those streets, and that would be a very big impact on the community itself, and we do take into concern the safety of the pedestrians that are walking on those streets. Most importantly and significantly to us is our children, and there are a lot of children who are out there. So in talking through you know, what the compromises might be, I haven't really heard any compromised option. I just hear that this is an access point that was planned as an access point, and the other access point is too expensive, so this is the direction that they would prefer to go. And to me, it comes down more to a cost decision versus making good planning sense. I also heard comments about the entrance being unsafe, where the bridge was deteriorating and causing unsafe conditions, but in the same comments, hearing that that was going to be used for potential utility access in emergency vehicles. So that doesn't really make sense to me either. And we bring up the issue of it being an older community. We do bring up the concern of emergency vehicle being able to access this community in an adequate amount of time, making sure that the safety of the community members is upheld. So with all those in mind, in our position being, we do want to see this community developed. We do want to see it take place, but we want to make sure that it's done in a way that addresses these very real concerns that we have. And I'd like to note that Caroline Anderson will yield her time back to the commission as she's taking care of our daughter outside. So thank you so much.
Chris Sheehan.
Hi, my name is actually Darren Sheehan, and Chris Sheehan is my wife, so we're in this together, okay? we live at 4801 Button Bush Drive, and we've lived there for 16 years, and at this point, we do have a concern because I'm going to echo everything that's been said here. I don't want to just keep repeating the exact same things, but there has to be another point of access to that road. And the gentleman just before me that's on Lazy River, that's another thing I was just going to bring up. We're going to have construction vehicles going in and out of there. We already have UPS and FedEx and everything else going. It just doesn't make sense at this point to not have a second access point for emergency vehicles for all this. And again, we have, like I said, I have young children. I've got a 10-year-old, I've got a 14-year-old, and one in college now. But we moved in that college. Daughter is now, you know, she was 3 years old at the time. But that's one thing there's a lot of small children, new children moving into that that road, and it's actually taking a left hard turn. So, you know, more vehicles coming through there are going to be zipping through there. No speed bumps. Again, I'm echoing everything that's already been said. It's definitely a concern. And we are parking on the street. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So Chris will not be speaking? Okay, I see you. Thank you. Okay, that was the last of the individuals that I have to speak against this issue. Well, you deferred your... Okay, she took more than that.
If I could just take 30 seconds.
Yes.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Chairman. Good evening. I'm a transplant from New York. I moved to North Carolina because this is where I wanted to live. This is the neighborhood I wanted to live in. I'm the lady on the block whose everyone's kids come to my house so they could go play with my dog, walk my dog. If this happens, parents are not going to be able to let their children come play with my dog. It's going to be too dangerous. So the elephant in the room is the cost. I drive a Nissan. Welcome to the neighborhood, but these people purchased the BMW, and now they're finding out they can't afford it. I can't help them pay for it. I bought what I could afford, and now you have to come up with the money for what you need and what you want. I'm sensitive to it. One day I'll need a community like this, but for now, I can't take the property value hit. I'm a single parent with a daughter going to college. I can't take that hit. You needed to plan for it, you didn't. So plan for it. And if you can figure it out, great, and welcome to the community.
Thank you. I'm going to close the public comments and portion of the hearing and bring this back to the commissioners. And I'm going to start to my Commissioner Al Turk, Commissioner Ghosh, Commissioner Brine, okay, Commissioner Gibbs, Commissioner Miller, and then I'll check back with the rest. Commissioner Al Turk.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So we're voting on a zoning map change, which means the existing zoning is RS20 and RS10. That means if the owners right now wanted to develop this land, they could do this without our recommendation, right, and the city council's, and they would, and they could build 31 single-family homes. That's to me, that is why I'm inclined to vote for this, because the impact is not so much the number of homes that will be in this development will be very much in line with and congruent with the neighboring community. However, I do, on the other hand, the traffic concern I think is warranted. It's I drove on Buttonbush yesterday, and there were a lot of people out there, I'm curious what it would take for the neighbors to be on board, or the neighboring community to be on board with this. Whether some traffic calming device, calming. I think the. Let me go to appendix. Sorry about that. 7, I think BPAC, the Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Commission, recommended a text commitment to provide traffic calming along Buttonbush and Lazy River roads. I'm wondering, this is a question both to the neighboring or the neighbors and the developer, whether they would consider this and whether this would alleviate some of the concerns. Someone else also mentioned the construction traffic, and I'm curious whether the developer can, Mr. Jewell, whether you can address that, if there's, it's possible to have construction traffic come through. I mean, I guess it would be Infinity Road would be the only option. Is that a possibility? Thank you.
Good question, and thank you for that. And obviously, there's a common theme tonight. And we've been aware of that. As I think most of you know, there is an existing dirt gravel driveway that extends from Infinity Road well into the property, almost three quarters of the way down to Buttonbush, as some of the speakers said. Buttonbush teed in or dead ended in and was never extended before because there wasn't a willing seller. Well, these folks were able to find a willing seller. The existing driveway has issues. The culvert being one, the way it's connected to Infinity Road. We have been exploring what it might take to upgrade that culvert and fix it so it would be safe and potentially bring construction traffic off of there. So that's something that I think could be done. I'd like to hear what the other commissioners have to say about that. And folks say your money, your problem, fix it, deal with it. I hear you, but if somebody came in and developed a single family neighborhood in here, they would probably make a street connection from Infinity Road all the way to Buttonbush. And in my experience, you would end up with more traffic than just this community would add, because people would be using that connection to get farther into the neighborhood. But that being said, you have real concerns, you have children, you're out there. If there's a way that we can keep that driveway open for day-to-day use, not necessarily improve it to a large extent, but do it in such a way that those members of the community who, are willing to drive on a driveway and get out Infinity Road that way. That's something that I think we'd be willing to consider. The cost of the turn lane, though, is a real thing. This is a small group of people. It's not Pulte Homes. It's not Standard Pacific Homes. The expense of a turn lane is a big expense. But I have been having some conversations with NCDOT and to some extent. Mr. Judge, you might want to weigh in, and if there's a happy medium, a way to keep that driveway open for day-to-day use, take the gate out, that sort of thing, and not have to put a left turn lane in, which I think is a possibility based on maybe fewer improvements out there, then I hopefully that's something that would help satisfy the neighbors and you that there's not just one way in and out of the project. I don't know if that was an answer or not, but it was a long soliloquy.
No, I was more curious whether there can be entrance for just for construction. I mean, not necessarily long term. I know that that can happen in some cases, but I don't know. Maybe it won't. It can't in this case.
Well, if the culvert is fixed, then I think there's an opportunity for construction traffic to go in and out of that. Okay. Yes.
And then any comment on traffic calming along Button Bush?
I'm not sure. I'd have to look at the situation, and we'd have to hear from the neighbors whether they felt traffic calming was a reasonable mitigation that would allay some of their fears about parking on the street and children and children and children. We heard that.
Thank you. Commissioner Ghosh.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'll just piggyback off that for a second. I'm glad to hear that you'd be willing to do that. Would you be willing to make a proffer to that nature that you would try to maintain access along?
I think there's a if we could work out a conditional proffer, but I certainly need to hear from Mr. Judge to see what impact it would have on you know his feeling about this project in terms of. Whether we'd have to go back through the back to staff again for analysis and that sort of thing before we could move forward with the Planning Commission, but I would like to hear what he has to say relative to if we were to, because we currently do show that access is an access for maintenance and emergency vehicles, and that's because of the low volume. It's not like the culvert is going to collapse today. But if we had traffic driving over there several times on a day-to-day basis, that's when it would get. That's when we'd be concerned about the structural.
See, I can appreciate that, and I'll just run the question to Bill Judge. And it seems to me it's a low number of units. It's age restricted, but I understand the point you're making. So, Bill, could you speak to what Dan is asking?
Bill Judge, Transportation. At this point, I'm not real certain, I guess, as to what the proffer would be, whether this would be a proffer for construction traffic or a vehicular connection in and out of the neighborhood. Depending on exactly what's being proposed would potentially impact, I guess, the result. If it's just a construction entrance, I don't know that would require any significant additional review. If they're proposing a full access, permanent access to serve the neighborhood, proposed neighborhood development, we would need to consult with NCDOT to determine whether or not a left turn lane was going to be required. I believe they have proffered that the community will be age restricted, which will further reduce the traffic impact. So I haven't had an opportunity to discuss that with NCDOT to determine whether or not they would require a left turn lane for an age-restricted community of 32 units or not?
Not that I'm asking you to. I guess what I would say is I'm a gambling man. I would venture to guess that a left turn lane might not be needed for an age-restricted community with 32 single and multifamily units with a community building. But I understand that you all are the applicants, so I'm asking if that proffer is there, if it's something you can make. If not, I understand there needs to be more review done, mm-hmm. because I think what you're saying is that the left turn lane essentially would price this project out. So
if there's a way to have a this would be a complicated proffer, but I think you've done more complicated before. If there was a way to commit to having a secondary access point onto Infinity Road, and by secondary I mean not as robust. It would continue to be a gravel driveway, modest, that sort of thing, but not trigger the need for a turn lane by NCDOT. So if a proffer could be caveated that way, and I think you've done that before, then I think that could be a reasonable way to provide additional permanent access to this community without burdening them.
I think I'm making this real complicated, but can you all speak to whether that kind of proffer is something that could be enforced?
We would need additional time to review a proffer of this magnitude. Based on the fact that we don't have exact wording in front of us, we haven't had time to review this, we would need to request a deferral of 60 days to analyze it.
Okay. Well, Dan, do you think 60 days, I mean, do you think a deferral is out of the question at this point? Or I mean, how, sounds like you're willing to work on this. I don't want to unduly delay the project, so.
60 days is a long time. And I realize it's we've got the holiday season coming up and that sort of thing, but is it, would it be impossible for us to spend a few minutes to try and word a proffer tonight to that extent?
I think it's worthwhile.
I think we've done it before to give it a shot. I'm willing to give it a shot.
Sorry, we are only at this point. This is the commissioner comment period, and so they can ask questions of individuals, but the neighbors have had an opportunity to speak. That would be up to Commissioner Ghosh to have a response to his questions.
Thank you, I appreciate the point. So why don't we try this? Why don't we hear from the neighbors? And Dan, if maybe you could work with Kyle and Bill to see if there's any kind of language you can come up with in the next few minutes for a proffer. I don't know that a proffer will be made tonight, but to the extent that one could be crafted with and such that the project wouldn't be delayed for 60 days, I think it's worthwhile to try it out. And I definitely am interested in hearing from the neighbors.
Good. Could I take a quick stab at a proffer just to start so we have a starting point on that? And that would be to keep the existing driveway connection open as a secondary private driveway with the caveat that it not have to be developed beyond the point where NCDOT would require a left turn lane. So in other words, I'm banking on that there's some there's some level of driveway connection where DOT will not require a turn lane. But so it leaves it a tiny bit open-ended, but I'm pretty sure there's some happy median there where DOT would say, okay, it's just a small driveway. We know people are going to use it, not to a huge extent. We're not going to require a left turn lane. That's my first stab. I'd be happy to hear what the Mr. Anderson has to say. Anderson, is that correct? Yes,
thank you. Thank you, Ben Anderson, again, 4330 Lazy River Drive. Thanks for the question, and actually the opportunity to talk about a compromise. This is something that came up in several of the meetings that we had as a community. What would be a compromise? I don't speak for everyone in the community. They may have their own personal opinions, but I speak for me in hearing the discussion and the questions that were brought up by the two commissioners here. In our discussions in the community, some of the ideas that were brought about, one being if you could still have an access point, one concern being access by emergency vehicles. If you can have a secondary access point from Infinity that would cover the ability for emergency vehicles, that would open us up to the idea of also being able to potentially put in some more speed bumps. As I understand it, and this could be validated, is one reason we cannot put more speed bumps into the community is because it limits, it puts it over the threshold of the amount of response time that emergency vehicles could get to the back of the neighborhood. So if you were able to have an access point for the emergency vehicles, maybe that would open up the conversation where we could potentially also have an incorporation of some additional speed bumps in an area of the neighborhood that does have a lot of children. Now the cost of that, I don't know where that would go, but that was one thing that was discussed among the community members is about the speed bumps, but not being able to do that because of the emergency access vehicles.
So thank you for that, and I appreciate the concern. My understanding was that as presented already without any additional proffer, that driveway was to be maintained for emergency access. So I don't know that the way it's presented now forecloses what you're suggesting. I think that it's actually still within the realm of possibility. And as far as adding speed bumps, I've heard conflicting points now, which is one, that too many speed bumps reduces the response time, and that's a matter of life and death. And so maybe I didn't quite catch the point, but it seemed like the suggestion was that there might already be too many speed bumps, so having an access from infinity would make more sense, especially given, the type of community that's being proposed. It would make more sense if emergency vehicles could access it from the driveway. But that's, my understanding was it's already, Dan, can you clarify that as already presented without any additional proffers, was the driveway going to be an access for emergency vehicles?
Thank you. Mr. Miller is always helpful. I'm going to peruse this quickly.
Sure.
While I'm getting ready to answer that. Yes, the condition on the note on our development plan was that driveway would be maintained for emergency vehicles and maintenance. And Mr. Anderson, is that kind of the extent to which you were suggesting?
I think emergency vehicles and construction vehicles, those are two concerns.
Okay, gentlemen, we are being televised, so if you're going to speak, you need to be at the podium so the people at home can hear what you're saying.
So I think, the main concerns being the emergency vehicles, if that is addressed through the secondary access, and I know that the concern being on the secondary access was the implementation of that turn lane, which is costing out potentially the project. So if that's not necessary, we don't want them to have to cost out, their project. At least, again, I speak from mostly myself up here. But I think in voicing the community concerns, that was one issue. And they're talking, and I know in the plans it had suggestions for traffic calming, speed bumps being one of the ideas of a traffic calming approach. But we weren't sure as the neighborhood, whether or not we could put more speed bumps in because of that emergency vehicle issue. So the emergency vehicle issue, the construction vehicles, if that could go to a secondary, I think that would address at least a lot of the concerns I and several others have had about the increase of those vehicles on the road on Button Bush Drive.
So if I may, I appreciate Mr. Miller doing a very quick and thorough job of writing the proffer that I was proposing to put forward. It seems though we may be down to something as simple as taking that existing notation that we have on our development plan that says for emergency vehicles and maintenance and adding the words and construction vehicle access to it. And I'm looking at staff, including Mr. Judge, to see if that seems like that's a relatively innocuous change and proffer to our plans.
Commissioner Ghosh, this is still in response to your question, so are they still responding to your question, or
I'm sorry to monopolize all of the time here, but I do think that this is an important proffer. So it very clearly is the main issue, I think, associated with the plan. So to the extent we can get it settled now, I think it'd be important. Sorry.
We have some other commissioners in the queue. If something is being worked on, we can at least have the additional comments. Mm-hmm. So why don't I move to the next commissioner, Commissioner Brine, and we'll get back to.
That sounds like a great idea, thank you.
Yes, and if I could interject, just a clarification, we had made a late change to the development plan before the last version got to you. It actually says existing gravel driveway to remain for construction and maintenance only, so the amendment would be and emergency vehicles.
Okay. Commissioner Brine.
Thank you.
I have some questions for staff. One of them refers to what was just brought up. It says on the development plan about the existing gravel driveway to remain for construction and maintenance only. The fact that it's written here on the development plan, does that commit them to that?
It is a considered a graphical commitment. However, it is currently that they can use it for that, not that they will. It'd be very difficult for them to actually propose something forward that would require them to use that.
Okay, well, I was thinking if they're going to use it, especially for construction, and leave it and add something about emergency vehicles, then it seems to me you're going to have to fix your culvert, whether you like it or not. And it also says the existing gate to remain. And the question there, is it going to be left unlocked?
Based on what we have on the plan today and what we've heard, if we're talking about construction equipment, maintenance, and emergency vehicles, the gate could remain because construction vehicles will have keys to the gate. Emergency vehicles will generally, what we do is we have double or triple locks on those gates, so if a fire truck needs to come in or an ambulance or something like that, they can cut a key and use the key. And as all the firemen have told me in Durham, they have the universal key known as 4-foot bolt cutters.
And I've heard several comments, I think, about this connection to the east. Several people have indicated they would like to see it disappear. Is that feasible?
Bill Judge with Transportation. Based on the Unified Development Ordinance and the length of the property, that that stub street connection is required under the ordinance.
And do you require, how many entrances are required for development of this size?
For a development of this size, you can have up to 90 units on a single point of access, so it's not necessarily needed to provide the second point of access, but it is needed for the overall street connectivity.
Okay. Thank you for that. Having driven around out there, I'm very much in favor of the fact of finding some way to have an access off of Infinity Road. It just makes no sense to me to have traffic go down Lazy River or some other access and then come down Buttonbush, and especially if it's an emergency vehicle for some reason, because there's speed bumps already on Lazy River, and if you add more to Buttonbush, you're really slowing down your response time. So you need to get some access to Infinity Road. And I'm also hearing a lot of discussion, which is good, since I like to see things reviewed and sort of decided on before I vote on it, I'm thinking we may have to look at a continuance.
Thank you, Commissioner Bryan. Commissioner Whitley.
Well, Commissioner Burnt just said what I was thinking. Jewel, I'm not in favor of voting for this. One, I don't think it was well thought out. Two, you will have that many people with only one access. No. And when you build, you're gonna have construction vehicles blocking the one exit. And there seems to me there needs to be a whole lot more conversation. Now, I am in favor of an extension. I just think that there needs to be more conversation where we can, where both the development group and the community itself can work this out. And to give yourself time to do that, I would vote for an extension. I just think that there's just too many questions, it's just too many people with one access. Once you build those 32 units, and you got vulnerable people in that, I'm a little over 50, just a little. But it means more health problems and only one exit. You know? And it seems to me the community at large should be able to come up with a remedy. And I think we need to just give ourselves enough time to be creative. Please consider an extension.
Thank you, Commissioner Whitley. Commissioner Miller.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. I have a question. Is it possible to develop this thing with no public-sized roads going through it? Can a development like this, of this number of units, be served entirely by private driveways?
Well, if shown on a development plan, private streets are permitted to serve single-family residential. There is the issue of the existing button bush right-of-way stubbing, so there would have to be some sort of termination extension of that.
So if they built a bulb on their property to make essentially what would be a cul-de-sac or maybe a Y to turn around or something like that, they could connect a driveway to that, then what this connection then that goes up to the east to Mr. Browning's property is for street connectivity, but there's no streets. When there are no streets, do you have to have a connection for street connectivity? And what would that look like? Do they have to make a street up to that even though they don't want one and won't use it?
So, Bill Judge, Transportation again. The ordinance considers private streets to have essentially the same standards as public streets so that they could be turned over and made public at some point in the future if the community desired. So there still would be the stub street. It would just be a private right-of-way.
All right, thank you. That helped a lot.
Yeah, Mr. Miller, could I piggyback onto that?
Sure, please.
We have done numerous townhouse projects in Durham and projects where you basically have a condominium form of ownership, which is exactly what this project is proposed to be, where you own your unit, but you don't own any of the other land. And on many of those projects, we have done private driveways. And there's a distinction. Private driveways don't have to meet private or public street standards. It would be very similar to, if any of you have visited the Eno Commons project, a co-housing community off Umpstead Drive. They have a driveway going around the perimeter of the property. So this would not, is in my understanding, at least based on my experience, need to be streets built to public street standards, even though they are private. And we have put on the development plan that these will be private, or can be private.
So under those circumstances, Mr. Judge, I want to make sure I understand before I pontificate. I'm going to pontificate, but I do want to understand. In other words, what's the distinction between the driveway that Mr. Jewell is talking about and the private street built to public standards that you're talking about, and what's going to be required here?
Yeah. Bill Judge of Transportation once again. We essentially have three street type standards. One are public streets, which everyone's familiar with. The second one is private streets, which are essentially required to be built to the same standards as public streets so that they could theoretically, if in the future it's desired to be turned over to the city for maintenance, it can be. The third standard, which Mr. Jewell was referring to, is allowed only for townhome and shopping centers, and we call them essentially private drives and common areas, and they're allowed for addressing purposes and other things, but they're essentially, as he indicated, common area that's parking lots for, yeah, we 10 o'clock, and they typically have parking on both sides of the street, and they act and function more like a private parking lot, but they may have street names for addressing and 911 purposes.
So if this property is developed out as a condominium, so that that all the buildings are commonly owned, and the owners of the individual owners only own inside the paint, they own the finishes on the floor and the paint on the walls, but they do not own the building and they do not own the land underneath, can they have the private drive? You said townhome, but I didn't. Is that the limit of it?
Yeah, I think it probably would be more to how the lots are arranged.
There would be no lots.
Yeah, so it would all be a single lot. I believe that would essentially qualify under similar to the multifamily like apartments where the private drives would be allowed.
And if it is private drives, do you still have to have the connection for street connectivity under the UDO? Do they have to build some sort of stub over there? And what would that look like?
The connection to the east would no longer, that section would no longer apply because there would not be a subdivision per se if it's still one lot with a condominium arrangement.
So we could get rid of that off the development plan.
That would be wonderful.
So we're making progress. I personally, right now the folks who live on Button Bush have the benefit of a dead-end street. If this goes through and the only access is Button Bush, then the folks in the co-housing wind up essentially co-opting the benefit that the Button Bush people have by moving it up. They wind up with the end of the dead-end street. I think that this thing ought to be developed with a private drive that connects to Infinity Road, so long as the DOT doesn't require a left-hand turn lane, similar to the thing I wrote. That's for everybody to use and to come and go. The only people who would be using it would be the owners in the co-housing, and they could choose to go Button Bush, or they could choose to go the other way, depending upon what was easiest for them. It's private drive, so the people on Button Bush would not cut through, and the people on Infinity Road who wanted to go into the surrounding neighborhood couldn't cut through either because it's a private drive. It seems to me that's the solution to this, and to eliminate that connection to the east, because it would be frightening to me because that creek continues to cut across the properties. If we wound up with a townhouse project on Mr. Browning's property at some point in the future, then now everything's draining onto Button Bush and it just gets worse and worse. So let's redraw this development plan so that we have a system of internal private drives that connects to Button Bush and connects to Infinity Road, assuming that the DOT doesn't require that left-hand turn lane. And then I think we can move forward. And I do want to address, if I can, Madam Chairman, and I know I've talked a lot now, when Mr. Stinson spoke, he addressed some issues that are important to me, but as far as I know, have not been made as proffers. He talked about a unit mix, units of one, two, or even up to four units in a building. I would like to see this development plan have a scheme for mixing units. That makes sense to me, so that we don't have one great big building with 20 units in it. Right now, you could do that, but I don't think that's what you intend. So let's talk about a unit mix that still allows the co-housing owners to participate in that planning process within some outside parameters. I also heard a reference to that there wouldn't be clear cutting, and I've heard in my mind by extension, there wouldn't be mass grading. I would love to see, if that's in fact true, I would like to see a proffer of a commitment to that. And I would also like to see a more realistic description of the building envelope here rather than just the edges of the property. I believe we could say where we plan to build here. without going clear up to the edge of the property. And I know that if I lived in the neighborhood next door, I would feel better about this, knowing, having a better or clearer picture about where these units were going to go. And if we could do those things, then I would be an enthusiastic supporter of this project, really. Because to me, I think that it's a great project. I want to vote for it, but I think it should not have a connection to the east, and it should have a driveway connection to Infinity Road, if it has a connection to Button Bush. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Miller. Commissioner Gibbs?
Well, after all that, could you clarify for me, please? Madam Chair, could I get a clarification of what was just said? We are still going to connect to Infinity and Button Bush, right?
We're not quite there.
Okay. So what we're talking about, since we're not there, we're talking about one entrance off of Infinity with private drives that go around that serves all the cluster housing and all of that. What?
Right now it's one entrance off Button Bush.
One entrance off Button Bush? Okay. I'll just have to hold on and wait to see how this works out. But I was just wondering, what do you think DOT would consider this entrance as a main driveway to Infinity when you consider all the single family houses up and down this road? They have a driveway that goes out into Infinity Road. Does density, being more than just a single family house, Dan, does that change the rules for having to have a turn lane?
I can never predict what DOT is going to do.
Yeah, I know.
My experience, though, is they have required us to put left turn lanes in for subdivisions, subdivisions being the key word,
yeah,
as small as 10 or 12 lots.
And
so
that's
why it's going to take a little more conversation or caveats, as Mr. Miller proposed here.
It almost seems like a rubber stamp kind of rule. Again, it depends on what kind of how they look at this thing, but before this subdivision, this concept is overtaxed or overburdened with money, I still think one of the accesses could still be off Button Bush. Button who? Button Bush, yes. My daughter lives in a community similar to this. It's a little more curvy. It may be a little more dense. And I keep hearing speed bumps. They don't have any speed bumps there. And I keep hearing people flying down around in the community. Are these people who live there, do you not have more control over the people who live there? Are they not more aware of each other? Are they not good enough neighbors to know what the situation is there? And it's I just think whoever lives in this new community would be neighbor enough to know that, yeah, there are going to be kids playing in the street, and there's going to be parking on both sides of the street. That means you got even less room, and you got to slow down that much more. After a while, it becomes, you expect to look out for kids more than you do for cars. I don't think it's going to be that much of a problem. Traffic is traffic, but people can work out things and live together peacefully. And I think this project would work well with your community. It's another opportunity for more friends. It's not just somebody that's infringing on your rights to play in the street. The street are for cars, but yeah, kids do use it. My grandkids use it, and I like to jerk a knot in the head when they go down the driveway and don't even look. So it's up to us, the new residents, to you, to make sure the kids communicate with each other by walking through the yards, like, or some way to peaceably connect these neighborhoods, because I think it would benefit both neighborhoods. That's just my piece on that. But when I went out there, the boulders and at the end of this cul-de-sac, it's kind of junky. There's boulders, trash, there's a rickety old wooden fence that's stuck up there. It's an eyesore to me to have a nice drive that goes up, well landscaped. I would prefer that. But that's a consideration I think that should be thought of too in our deliberations.
Thank you, Commissioner Gibbs. Commissioner, I have closed the public hearing for public comments. Now, unless one of the commissioners is responding to a question that is being asked, I can't really call on individuals from the audience again. Commissioner Busby, and then Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I agree with a lot of the comments Commissioner Miller made a few minutes ago, but in particular, we're not ready to vote tonight. We have far too many issues that have to be resolved. I'm sorry that folks have to come back, but I agree with Commissioner Whitley. To do this right, we need to continue this hearing. There are far too many questions. I do have a question for staff. I do understand that the developer would rather not have a continuance for 60 days. To me, 60 days seems like the appropriate amount of time, but to ask staff, is this something to resolve the multiple issues, including a potential proffer as well as a request for some additional descriptions that were put forward but not officially as proffers? Can this be done in 30 days, or do we need to have a 60-day continuance? And then I'm prepared to make a motion after Commissioner Freeman has a chance to speak.
The problem with a 30-day continuance would be the fact that the internal deadlines for all of the items for next Planning Commission have already been passed. The other issue is that we are coming up in the holiday season, so there are vacations and other things of staff being not available at that time.
Thank you. That's an appropriate response. I will, at the appropriate time, support a 60-day continuance.
Commissioner Freeman.
Thank you. I honestly don't think we need a continuance, but I would like to hear from the resident that has been trying to get to the mic and hear exactly what she's trying to say about that dead end, that button bush.
Okay.
Thank you. There's been a proffer, and I think it would probably just have an argument at the next hearing, because the proffer doesn't actually add anything. It's inadequate. The driveway needs to be the only access, and this is why, because they can close the gate at any time and override you. You've spoken, and then they'll shut it in your face because you are the ones that are telling them what to do. But if you don't actually put in place what the wording that needs to happen to have your will on the community, then it's a waste of time. So if they are allowed to lock the gate, then there's no point. So we're encouraging a continuance. They've had so long, they've known all along that we didn't want this and that we welcome them. There are hundreds of kids on Halloween. They can come to my porch. We will welcome them and give out candy. We have luminaries at Christmas. They can walk around and have hot chocolate with us. Welcome, come. We will meet you. We will embrace you. Put a walkway between. Walk your dogs. Come on exercise walks. Whatever you want to do to be part of our community. But the driving, the construction is what we're not interested in. That's why Buttonbush needs to be blocked, and that's my proffer, and having the other one open completely with no gate.
Thank you, Ms. Rizzuto.
I would just like to close and say, or finish out my comments in saying that the way it stands now and the conversation that we're having around the co-housing providing a private drive is enough for me to support this and move forward. I don't think we need a continuance.
Commissioner Ghosh, I promise to return to you.
Thank you, and again, I apologize for taking up everyone's time. I do want to say, I agree. I think that with the keeping the private or the driveway open for access for emergency vehicles and construction traffic, I think makes the project something I can support today. I do understand Commissioner Miller's comments, and you know, I definitely understand the adjacent property owner who doesn't want that connection, that street connection made or shown on the plan. I can understand where you're coming from with that. I will say it is scary to see it on the plan, but if it's a street that's never put in by another development, say when you sell your property to a developer who wants to make a subdivision, then that street is actually never going to come in while you own the property. I mean, at least that's been my experience. But I still understand the point, and I think that what Commissioner Miller suggested is an interesting way to kind of get rid of that requirement. I did want to touch on something else, and that's, first of all, the overall idea of this community. I think it's great. First of all, I think it's innovative. I realize there's other ones in Durham, but I'm really glad to see that this type of community is something that's coming to Durham or wants to be in Durham. I think it's a great type of community. And I also just want to address a concern of mine that I've seen with a lot of development proposals, not just this one. And to the credit of most everyone who spoke, I think that, you know, most everyone who spoke said this is going to be a great community, can be, and the people are going to be nice neighbors. But sometimes we get comments about, you know, how the community be closed off, or we can't have our kids in the street or anything anymore. The interesting thing about this case is that we actually know who the neighbors are going to be. They're sitting right there. And so I find it very difficult, or I mean, just I'm impressed with people who can come to the mic and say, I can't support this. I think the neighbors will be bad. I think it'll be bad for my kids, that type of thing. You're talking to the people right there. And I think that's unfortunate. I think we should be able to have a more meaningful conversation and a more polite conversation, to be frank. So I, you know, if this does get deferred, I would hope that when people come back to speak again, they can speak nicely about the neighbors that are going to be there, particularly given that they're sitting in the room. It's bad enough when people talk about these supposed, you know, people moving into a new development, they're going to be criminals or something like that. No one said that tonight. I understand that, but I don't understand why there's this a visceral action to new people moving into your area. They seem to be very nice people, and I'm sure they will welcome your kids. At any rate, I would support this, but I understand that there are a lot of concerns on the Planning Commission. So I know Commissioner Busby said you would make a motion. I would hope that that motion would be for approval, but I understand that there are some other concerns that might need to be addressed.
I think we're ready for some action. So Commissioner Busby.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. And again, I appreciate everyone's time. I offer this motion in the spirit of let's get it right, as opposed to let's do it fast. I would move case number Z160014. I'd move that we continue this for two cycles.
Second.
I have a motion. I didn't hear the second. Which it was with. I have a commotion. I have a commotion. Thank you. I have a motion by Commissioner Busby and a second by Commissioner Whitley that we defer the item for, that we continue the item for two cycles.
To the January meeting.
Which is to the January meeting? No.
February.
It has to be the February meeting. Okay, we kind of really fluffed that up. So let me be clear on the motion. Okay. Let me be clear on the motion that we, our motion is to defer, continue this item for two cycles until February. Is that, and I do have a second, so is there discussion?
I would just like to, I'm just wondering if we add that the gravel drive can be used for emergency vehicles. And I'm just wondering whether the applicant wants to continue this for 60 days just for the, I guess, the future street connection, or whether you would like us to vote on it as is. I just, because I know you're hesitant to defer it. That's all.
Yes, please, Mr. Harris, Commissioner Harris.
To the, new commissioner members, we're not supposed to be accepting propers at our commissioner meeting. If there is any type of change to the presentation that we have here in the books, it should be continued. That was, about a year and a half or 2 years ago that was put in play, because we were here at 11, 12 o'clock working on propers. So.
And we could be tonight.
If anything changed from what was in our packet, it's supposed to be continued. They work it out. And the packet should be complete when they come to us. And we shouldn't have to work it out.
So are we ready for the question that's presented? All in favor of the motion?
We need a roll call.
Let's do a roll call.
Thank you. Mr. Al Turk?
No.
Mr. Bryan?
Yes.
Mr. Busby?
Yes.
Ms. Freeman?
No.
Mr. Ghosh? Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson?
Yes.
Mr. Kinchin?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
Yes.
Mr. Whitley?
Yes.
Do I get to vote?
Mr. Gibbs?
No.
Motion carries 8-4.
We can fix that.
Thank you, Mr. Jewell. So all of these. eighth item, Jovan Revision, item number Z1600033. We're ready for our staff report.
Thank you, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. So this is a request initiated by the Durham City County Planning Department. This is a project that is located currently within the city's jurisdiction, and this is a request to change a property from plan development residential 4.840 to plan development residential 4.840. Technically, there is no modification to the previously approved development plan at this site. That development plan was approved approximately 2006 by the Durham County Board of Commissioners. Subsequently, the subject site was annexed into the city of Durham last year with these previous approvals. The subject site is highlighted in red in front of you. The entire site going down to Ellis Road was part of the previous rezoning in the mid-2000s. As you can see, at that time, it was for a number of different zoning districts. The portions to the south have been separately rezoned by the city. That was actually approved earlier this year. The intent of this particular rezoning request is to remove one text commitment from that previously approved development plan. Again, there's no other modifications proposed to anything that was approved, and the density will stay the same. The removal of that text commitment is seen on the screen here in front of you. This is at the time of building permit, the applicant shall pay a voluntary school impact fee of $1,000 per single family lot and $300 per multifamily unit, with credit given appropriate against any other impact fees that may be in place. The result of the request to remove this text commitment comes as a settlement agreement between the City of Durham, the Durham Public Schools, and the property owners. They jointly agreed that the city would submit this request to remove this text commitment from the development plan. Again, that is the only modification which is proposed as part of this request. On the future land use map in front of you, the site meets the future land use map. Again, it's presently zoned PDR, and that meets the intent of the future land use map. The comprehensive plan policies, the site, when it was originally approved, met all of the appropriate comprehensive plan policies. And again, this request, there's no modification which would impact its effect on these policies. So in terms of a determination, staff has determined that this request is consistent with the comprehensive plan and applicable policies and ordinances, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you all may have regarding this request.
Since I have no individuals to speak on this issue, I'm going to close the public hearing and return the to the commissioners to see if there are comments about this particular issue. Commissioner Miller?
Jacob, you said settlement agreement. This is to resolve litigation over this issue? And
yeah, Jacob Wiggins with the Planning Department. Yes, it was. Yeah, it was a court-ordered settlement.
Other commissioners would like to speak to this issue? Commissioner Bryan?
I'm simply going to make a motion that we move Jovan Revision case Z1600033 forward with a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Excuse me. Motion by Commissioner Bryan, second by Commissioner Miller, that we move item number Z1600033 forward with a favorable recommendation. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Ayes have it. Next item. The next item that we have is a public hearing for the Unified Development Ordinance text amendment. Do we have a staff report?
Yes, thank you. Michael Stock with the Planning Department.
It's a late hour, so I'll try to be as succinct and brief as possible. Text amendment TC 16002 proposes technical amendments regarding traffic impact analysis standards within the Unified Development Ordinance. As you may be aware, TIA is a professional study regarding the impacts of a proposed development on the roadway system and indicates any necessary improvements to that system as part of a proposed development. The UDO establishes a period of validity for TIAs, and staff has applied this period of validity to all TIAs, including those submitted as part of a zoning map change with the development plan. The city attorney's office has advised that the current text of the UDO would not allow a period of validity to be applied to a TIA associated with the development plan, and this has been confirmed by the planning director. Therefore, staff has initiated the text amendment to clarify that the expiration of a TIA also applies to TIAs approved with development plans and to establish procedures when such a TIA has expired. Those procedures generally are twofold. A new TIA would be required if a site plan is submitted after the expiration date. And expiration dates are usually 8 years, so it's a generous expiration date as it is. So if a new TIA would be required, and if only additional mitigation measures or no mitigation measures are needed, then they would just proceed on with site plan approval and do what's committed to in the development plan. If there are modifications, then that would be considered a significant change and would go back to through the development plan review process. Joint City County Planning Committee reviewed the proposed amendments at its August 3rd, 2016 meeting. And there were no significant or additional revisions. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
I have no one who has signed up to speak to this issue, so I'm going to return to the commissioners to see if commissioners would like to speak. I'll start with Commissioner Ghosh. Anybody else on this side?
I probably have a question, but about the same as his.
Okay. Okay, Commissioner Ghosh and Commissioner Miller.
Thank you. So I've talked with staff about this before, and so Michael Stock, I think, is aware of my concerns with it. My main concern is on page 2, at the top of the page, number 2, and part of the issue, I think, with this is that essentially it minimizes or in some ways treats the zoning, a development plan is zoning, treats it as something that can expire. And it was explained to me by staff, and it's a point that I agree with, that while you may not be able to, after 8 years, develop to the full extent of the development plan, you could probably develop within the confines of the development plan to a lesser number of units or less intense use or something like that. And not have to go through a rezoning. And I agree, I think that's a fair point. I think there are only a few scenarios where that wouldn't be the case. For example, if you somehow on your development plan, spelled out the use very, very specifically, such that the only type of use that could be put there would be whatever it is that's requiring you to submit a new TIA. But I think those are probably, that probably won't come up often, but if it does come up, my concern is that, it's an area of perhaps liability for the city. The other issue that I think this text change doesn't consider is if a development takes longer than 8 years or 5 years as the case may be. It just seems to me that it would be an unfair scenario for a development that took longer than 8 years to complete, that after that eighth year, they're having to redo a TIA and then change the rules up, where now they might have to widen the road even more or whatever than what they had previously committed to. My understanding is that that could happen under this scenario. And I think it would be, if there could be a provision that address multi-phase projects that take longer than 8 years and somehow, give that scenario more consideration, I think that would be useful. But, I definitely understand the concern where a TIA has expired and no longer, a development under the previously approved zoning might not make sense. Although, to me, that it does raise another issue, which is, if you didn't develop in 8 years, why would the TIA suggest that you need to do more than what you previously had to do if your development that had been approved would be taken into consideration with any TIA that was done afterwards? So I think could be an issue with, are you really tying additional TIA commitments to the proposed development if the proposed development doesn't really change and hadn't been developed previously? So those are my concerns with it. I think it's an issue that needs to be addressed, but I don't know that this is the perfect text change. Not that we can only approve perfect text change, but I think you get my point. Thank you.
Commissioner Miller.
So you've hit exactly the thing that has upset me. This essentially says that when a TIA is connected to a development plan rezoning, that somehow the development plan itself expires. Well, it can't expire. It's the law. Essentially you're saying if you got to do a new TIA, fine. But if the new TIA says that there are things new modifications that are required that weren't contemplated in the previous TIA, that's a deviation, and that you're going to require the property owner to go through a rezoning. You cannot, under the law of this state, require anybody to apply for a rezoning. In my opinion, that TIA stays, and that's just the way it goes. I mean, what about rezonings that don't require TIAs? They face the same issues. I mean, if I don't develop my property in 3 years, 4 years, 10 years, and all the neighbors around me develop it super intense, and now I come along, I still get to, the zoning is the zoning. You cannot make somebody go through a rezoning, and you can't tell them, no, you can't submit a site plan when a site plan is required. And that's what the effect of this would be, is you've got to submit a new TIA. You might be able to tell them that they have to do that, but if that TIA indicates according to some standard and somebody says, okay, we want you to do something different than your development plan said you had to do, therefore you either can't rezone or we won't approve your site plan, that's where this runs slam into the law of the state of North Carolina, and I can't support it.
Yeah. Does it require a response?
No.
Okay.
Madam Chair, yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to invite the staff to offer their feedback, particularly on the comments from my fellow commissioners, just to help me understand the intent of the proposal in front of us, and then if there are any changes that might be needed based on this input.
Yeah. Yes, Bill Judge with Transportation. The intent of the ordinance as written, if you go back to the section one right before it on the previous page, if someone does a rezoning with a TIA, and let's say there's 4 roadway improvements required, and it's been more than 8 years, they do the new TIA. The new TIA says those same 4 are required plus a fifth one's required. If they're willing to do all 5 of those, they can simply go through the site plan process if they're willing to agree to that. If the TIA comes back and says, well, only 3 of those are required, the new TIA, because traffic conditions or whatever have changed, 3 of them are required and maybe a fifth one still required, but the fourth one wasn't. If they're still willing to do that fourth improvement, the rezoning is not required. But if they wish to seek relief from that improvement that the new TIA now shows is no longer needed or required or can be modified, that's when the rezoning would be required.
The also issue is that these are all proffers. So development plan is coming to you, and all the commitments that are put on it with the TIA are proffers. As Commissioner Ghosh has pointed out, that almost, I'd say 99% of the development plans that come forward
don't limit themselves to a very specific use. It's usually either a maximum or there's a range of uses allowed. So there's instances, and he raised a point, and we did consider, and that was one of the reasons why we pulled it off of the October meeting, because we wanted to address his concerns. Again, all these concerns were raised and discussed with the city attorney's office. That we were going to create a zoning issue that Commissioner Miller brought up. But the way, and if we need to take a look at, tweak the wording a little bit to make it a little bit clearer as to the intent, we'll do that. These are all proffers. If you're going to self-limit yourself to a use, you've limited yourself. It is not a mandate of the zoning that was on the books. It was a proffer as part of the development plan. So there was not a concern by the city attorney's office that this was undermining state statute in terms of zoning and the ability to keep it, that zoning lasts the lifetime. As Bill indicated, the intent is that if only there was a modification that the applicant wasn't going to be willing to do, that they felt that, well, they wanted to get out of that committed element, then they are going back to the Planning Commission and through the entire rezoning process.
Commissioner Freeman.
I hear what Commissioner Ghosh and Miller are saying. I personally have an issue. Well, I appreciate the intent of this in that we just went through Ephesus Church Road. And similarly, I mean, traffic conditions change. I've been on the side of fighting against the road widening on Austin Avenue. And if we happen to get that changed, I wouldn't want any new developer coming in to have to still have to meet the same requirement. You know, to still, if it were possible to make sure that it was clear that the changes have been made already, and that as I'm sorry, tell me your name again.
Mike
had mentioned, and they were actually able to just go through with it, then fine. But if the changes need to be made, I think they need to come back to the commission, and it's important that. Everyone has a chance to hear it out in the open, not just in the back room.
Yeah, but that's not what we're talking about here.
Commissioner Miller.
Thank you. So a proffer is an offer by a developer in a development plan, but when the council approves the rezoning, it becomes an ordinance. It becomes the law that applies to that piece of property. And you cannot include in your zoning ordinance anything that requires somebody that denies their ability to develop their property unless they apply for a rezoning. And that's the issue that the way I read this could happen. I mean, if it comes along and you get a situation where if you're only worried about those things where people have committed in their development plan to things that they subsequently prove not to have to do, and you want to say if that occurs, you still have to go through the rezoning process so that we can strike it out. That I can live with, because that's true, because the alternative is you can build it anyway. My concern is the flip side, is that a new TIA would indicate a different set of things are required, an extra turn lane or another stoplight or something like that. That is not contemplated in the original committed elements. And in my opinion, you cannot say, well, you cannot build on your property until you have applied for a rezoning and we've got new committed elements. That, in my opinion, the law does not permit.
Specifically where safety is concerned, I would disagree.
Well, it doesn't make any difference whether it's safety or not.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Not a back and forth conversation. Let me recognize at least one at a time because
okay.
We can't.
I'm done.
Thank you. So Commissioner Freeman, do you have additional comments?
Just in noting that I hear what you're saying, but if there's nothing to make them come back to the process, I'm concerned.
Thank you. Commissioner Ghosh.
Piggyback off Commissioner Miller's comments, those are exactly my concerns, and I did raise them, and as Mike Stock mentioned, the planning department did look at that along with the city attorney, and I actually spoke with the city attorney myself. And I will say that my understanding, and I don't want to mischaracterize anything, but my understanding from the conversation we had was that the city attorney is aware of this issue and evidently is not concerned, because there are very few circumstances where the property will be rendered undevelopable without rezoning. And I think that's what Mr. Stock was mentioning. There's only, 99% of the time you could develop the property under the constraints of the development plan without any additional TIA or road improvements needed. So, for example, if your development plan said a maximum of 100 residential units and that required 4 road improvements, the point that the planning department and the city attorney's office have come up with is, if you wanted to 8 years later, 9 years later, develop 100 units, and the TIA says, well, instead of 4, you have 5, you always have the option of doing 80 units, in which case you only have to do the 4 road improvements. So the property is not rendered undevelopable. And so that is, I think, the position that the city has taken on this matter. Although I will say that I still can't support it. I mean, I understand the point, but I still view this as a presenting an opportunity for liability, and I can't really support that. But I did want to explain what I got from the city attorney's office.
I'll recognize Commissioner Brine, and then Commissioner Freeman has some additional comments.
excuse me. I agree with Commissioner Ghosh and Commissioner Miller. And I'm very concerned because there is a major development in South Durham, which will go unnamed, which has taken a very long time to even begin to get started. They did a major TIA, and they are responsible for many, many, many road improvements, which has been mentioned in many other development plans that have come forth since then. And unfortunately, I think if they were told that they might have to do a new TIA because the old one has expired, they wouldn't bother to come talk to the city attorney. They would go talk to their friends in the General Assembly, and we might have changes that we don't want.
And I can't help but say, specific to that point, I'm not afraid. And I don't think we should be afraid, and we shouldn't operate from fear. Because if the General Assembly wants to continue to act in the way that it has, we should welcome it. And we need to continue to do what we need to do in this city and this county, which is to continue to do, to set the precedent, not to bend to their will. It just rises up for me as an issue. Like, there should be no fear on this.
Commissioner Brine, and then we're going to call for a vote.
I'm not speaking out of fear. I'm just pointing out a potential case that might come up.
Can I get a motion for this?
I'll move it. Madam Chairman, I'm going to move that the Planning Commission send the technical change contained in TC 16-0024 to the City Council with a favorable recommendation. I will be voting against it.
Second.
I have a motion by Commissioner Miller and a second by Commissioner Freeman that we send the UDO text amendment technical changes number TC 16-0002 forward with a favorable recommendation. Let's have a roll call, please.
Mr. Alturk?
No.
Mr. Brine?
No.
Mr. Busby?
No.
Ms. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Ghosh?
No.
Mr. Gibbs?
Yes.
Mr. Harris?
Yes.
Ms. Hyman?
No.
Mr. Johnson? Mr. Kinchin?
Yes.
Mr. Miller?
No.
Mr. Whitley?
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Gibbs. Oh, he did vote. He voted yes. Okay.
Yes.
Sorry.
I was just asking.
4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The motion carries 7-5. No. Fails 7-5.
Fails.
5-7.
The motion fails 5-7.
Thank you.
I just want to take a moment and say that as commissioners here, you really are going to have to, I don't want to call you out, but there has to be a stance made, and you can't base your opinions or your arguments on what the state is going to do. We're not going to get anywhere like that.
Thank you, Commissioner Freeman. Let's move to the next item, which is new business. The 2017 meeting dates.
Good evening, Commissioners. Sarah Young with the Planning Department. Before you, you have your schedule set out for 2017 according to your general meeting date. This year, there were no adjustments due to holidays or anything, so the schedule is before you, but you do need to adopt it.
Madam Chair, I move adoption of the proposed 2017 Planning Commission meeting dates. I'm sorry.
I got a second. Commissioner Free. Okay. Motion by Commissioner Busby that we approve the 2017 calendar. Second by Commissioner Freeman, who also was trying to ask for something else. But all in favor of this. You're not ready for the question. Commissioner Bryan.
Just out of curiosity, when did Valentine's Day cease being a holiday?
They don't get it off, so what they don't care.
When I got married.
What a great answer.
I was in the middle of a serious motion. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you. The next item that we have old business, and I'm just going to mention this briefly. This is about Planning Department work program and budget requests. I will be submitting a budget on behalf of the commissioners, the Planning Commission, by January 6. The budget will include some additional funds for training. I'm going to put together a proposal, but I would also like to hear from any of you if you have some ideas as to how we can do this and train our commissioners on a rotating schedule based on the number of classes that are being offered. It's 14 of us, which means that, you know, we're going to have limited funds to do this, so we will need to come up with a measure that allows us at least one or two courses, and I'll need to be able to justify that. And there will be no reimbursement process, so for those individuals who decide that they want to go ahead and take the classes, we have not been able to come up with a reimbursement process per se. So what I put in this budget is what we're going to have to defend. It needs to be compelling. So I will put it together. If you have some input, I'd like to have it, but it will be done by January 6. Any questions?
Madam Chairman, I've taken the classes, so you have 13 people.
13 people, okay. And you have taken, then I will hear from both of you as far as the cost of the, you know, the cycle. So I will be getting some input about the classes. Ms. Commissioner Whitley.
When will we see the budget? I mean, when will we see your proposal?
Before January 6. so that you can have some input. So if I don't hear from you, then I'll send you what I have. But I must get it to Sarah by January 6th. Any questions? Okay.
I have an item that would probably go under the old business.
Okay, great.
And it has reference to the guidelines for the submittal of development plan and committed elements. And strictly, this is was adopted by the city in September 6, 2006. And it was brought back up to us on April the 19th, 2012. And I would like to reference just one paragraph of that document. It's section D, paragraph 2. And it says, applicants are required to submit any proposed or potential committed elements to the planning staff at least 5 business days before the public hearing. If an applicant proffers a committed element at a public hearing that has not been reviewed in advance, staff will automatically request a 2-cycle continuance to allow time for adequate review. And that's paraphrasing that second paragraph. And I would like for staff, if you don't mind, to just send us a copy of that so we can be mindful of what we're not supposed to be doing here.
Thank you, Commissioner Harris. I appreciate that.
Commissioner Harris, I just want to be clear. It said staff.
Thank you, David.
The chair recognizes Commissioner Freeman.
Did it say staff specifically in that
staff
paragraph?
Staff would recommend to us.
So if staff doesn't recommend it to us.
We should know this.
We as an advisory board have the freedom to move past it, is what you're saying?
No.
If staff would just remind us again that we're not supposed to be proffering, working on proffers at our commission meetings.
Okay, and let's move to the next item, announcements.
Wait a second, Madam Chairman. We were given at our last meeting as a handout, although it's dated October 19th, City County Planning Department future projects draft, and that was with a cover memo. And at my request, since we hadn't had time to go over it, I wanted to read it and then bring it back up at this time. We deferred action on it.
Let me be clear that we're still under old business then.
That would be old business.
That was the old business.
Okay, thank you.
This is connected with that.
Okay.
So the staff has the high priority and medium priority projects, and I'm assuming if there's a low priority category, you don't list those. They're that low. And I just wanted a chance to say that I have gone over this and looked at them. And I have a couple of other projects. I think it's appropriate for the Planning Commission to advise the City Council on this if we all agree to do it. There are a couple of things that I would add to the priority things and maybe even demote a couple of priority items down to medium if everybody agreed. I would like to have us undertake while there's still time, a comprehensive rezoning plan for the larger East Durham area. And that would include looking at the zoning for this larger East Durham zoning area, including in that how it relates to the proposed Alston Avenue compact tier. I really want to make, we have one chance to see a revitalization and redevelopment of East Durham, one chance to get it right, and to let it happen parcel by parcel, project by project, zoning case by zoning case just doesn't seem to me to be the way to go. When I look at the zoning atlas for the city of Durham, the place where the zoning is incongruent with a use on the ground and any kind of sensible sort of organization and arrangement, it's East Durham. And it seems to me that I would like to get over there. I don't want to do a whole small area plan or anything like that. I just want to deal with zoning and say, you know, this it seems to me there are just millions of little things that under any other circumstances would be spot zones. And how they got there, I don't care about. A lot of them don't even matter anymore there, because so much of the land over there has become vacant through teardowns. But I would like to get over there and say, if we're going to have a renewed interest in developing East Durham, it can't be the Wild West. It needs to be, we need to think it through. And so I would like to add that to our list of priority projects. Another area that I would like to do at some point, if not a project for planning staff, a project for the staff and the commission to do together. We get lots of rezoning requests. I seem to spend a lot of time driving over to places over in the I-70, I-47, I-40 corridors, and back and around, I don't know if you went over and looked at that Joven property. Gosh, you have to drive all over around and to get back in there and to see what they're doing back there. I worry that, again, we're doing it a piece of property at a time. When I would like to see a bigger picture, I would like to have a time when somebody shows me on the screen saying, this is our vision for these corridors that are the hot places for development. And so when we look at Ellis Road here, and then around the corner we've got this Joven property, and you have to drive all over Hell's Half Acre to get to it, but when in fact it's practically next door, I would like to and maybe it's just my fault, I don't have a clear vision of what we want that part of Durham to look like. And I would love to get together and look at the map and say, this is what we want. And if I had to drop things off the high priority project list down to medium priority in order to accomplish that, I would look at item 6 and item 7 there. And maybe even item 8. Now, of course, I don't realize, because I don't know how these got on here. I haven't been on the Planning Commission long enough to be so familiar. I don't know whose ox I'm goring by suggesting that these should move down a category. But I know that not everything can be high priority. And so if you want to add a high priority item, you ought to knock one down. It seems to me that 10 is enough. That's a good number. Moses worked with that number, as I recall. and he still hasn't actually implemented all of them. The medium priority projects, I don't have a problem. I don't have a problem with those. But at some point, I would love to be able, as a advisory body to the city and the county, to say, we think you ought to add this project. And that East Durham project, to me, is really important because the time is right now.
Yes, Stan, Sarah.
So it might be helpful to explain what this magical list before you is. It is not a list that says that we will do the high priority projects first or the medium priority projects last, or that we will do any certain amount of projects in any given year. It is just a working list for staff to be able to, when we put together our work program proposal based on feedback, we will have a conversation at the beginning of the year the Joint City County Planning Committee, which is the committee that helps guide the work of the planning department. As you know, the work program for the department is set by the city and the county, our bosses, the managers, and the council and commissioners. What we use this list for is kind of a springboard to have discussion with the Joint City County Planning Committee. I assume that what will happen is they will pick things from that list. They may move things around. I need to finish looking at the existing work program and see how far we're actually going to get this year, how much rollover of projects that are multi-year projects will happen in future years, and the amount of capacity that's going to leave me in staff resources, how much we could add back next year to kind of compensate for things that we're going to clear off the docket this year. So don't let the medium priority, high priority trip you up. That's nothing other than staff's cursory evaluation of what we may or may not want to as our staff recommendation push for, but it has no other meaning. It's not an adopted list in any way. It's a working list. So I would just caution, don't get hung up on that something needs to be moved. It's our list, and nothing needs to be moved. It's just a menu to choose from.
Then if I may, Madam Chairman.
Wait a minute, can I have some input before we do that?
The chair recognizes Commissioner Whitley.
I am happy.
11th Amendment.
That we want to do something to make to get some contiguous zoning done. There are 5 focus spots in Northeast Central Durham. They're already designated. And none of those 5 spots have consistent, zoning goes all the way back 40, 50 years, and it looks like a quilt of different colors, would that be so wonderful? You have 13, might be more, but I know 13 neighborhoods that have active communities in them, out of those 5 focus spots. We would have to work out some kind of system so that they could have some input. I think the council will look upon that favorably. Yes, I think there are at least 4 votes or more to make that happen. Thank you for bringing it up. I'm very proud of my fellow commissioners for even thinking about it.
Madam Chair.
Commissioner Bryan had, did you have a, and then.
My comments will be brief. Just on item 2 on the list, when you're looking at compact neighborhood future land use map, take a close look at what was done out on the edge of Research Triangle Park, because I think you've put some things in place there that don't belong. We dealt partially with one of them with a rezoning case, but that area is not really designed to have compact neighborhoods around it. You're literally looking at transfer stations. And then I really had a question about item number 6, the Durham Technical Community College. I'm assuming you're talking about both the North and South Campus?
I think it's just the South Campus, to be honest.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yep. I would say the point you just brought up about the compact neighborhoods around RTP, you'll notice that those were not part of the most recent compact neighborhood update project that we did. Those are basically on hold for our purposes. We will at some point go back and revisit them when we kind of see the resolution of the longer range plans for rail. But we are not actively working on those. Those are kind of in a holding pattern to see what the future may bring. That may be something that we tackle in a future comprehensive plan, which I'm not 100% sure what version of the high and medium priority list you have, but
it's the one dated October 19th.
Does it have the comp plan at the top?
Yes.
As number 1?
It does.
Okay, good.
And
so
it was given to us at our last meeting.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. I know I've made a few amendments to it, and I'm not 100% sure when I date those, but and also in regard to a comment, Commissioner Miller, that you made in terms of the vision for certain corridors, I think that's another one of those things that staff feels like the current comprehensive plan does a poor job of actually setting out a vision. If you actually read the comprehensive plan, it doesn't really have a comprehensive vision for development. Has a lot of it has a lot of disparate policies covering a lot of subject areas, and some policies are stronger than others. But if someone were to say, how do you want Durham to develop? And we would say, go look at the comprehensive plan, they wouldn't find anything. So that is something that staff would certainly covet your support on as we move forward, because I think that is overarching and can really kind of reset the tone for all of Durham, really.
I think we're making a mess case by
case. Yeah, sure.
Commissioner Gibbs.
I have a question about Commissioner Miller's East Durham comments. First of all, is it to also establish the size, the area of, quote, East Durham? And will we have any official input? How will this develop? Because if it requires a committee or something, I would like to be the first to join up.
May I respond,
yes.
Madam Chairman? I don't have a set vision. And I do think that what is East Durham matters, so that would be one of the things. What is East Durham? I have an idea. It may not correspond to your idea, but I do think we have neglected it for a long time, but the development community has rediscovered it. And I don't want them to redevelop it based on a regulatory environment that is is the result of a lot of neglect. It's time to get in there and say this is, make a plan for it. And again, I know that it's tempting to want to make some sort of gigantic comprehensive plan, but I'm afraid I don't want to choke on anything. Right now, what I'm interested in is the way it's zoned. And so I would love at some point, and I would like to be advised by staff on this, if I may, Madam Chairman, on how we make it, how we can discuss this issue and just come up with a collective recommendation, if that's what you want to do as a planning commission. I mean, we're supposed to be advising the city and county. I would like to offer some advice on what to do about East Durham, if we can come to consensus, and then to, in consultation with staff, how to communicate any advice we have concerning that to the council. And I took this project list, which I found to be actually, I took a lot of comfort in this. It's like, okay, people are thinking about stuff. I took this as an opportunity to say maybe if we can append something to this to get it in, to get it on somebody's list so that it gets churning and it goes to the JCCPC and it goes to the city council and it goes to the board of commissioners and it's also considered by the director, the planning director and his advisors. I think it's something that we need to do. I think we're going to good planning and zoning means that we make a plan and that we stick to it. And I'm worried that we've treated East Durham badly, and it's time to treat it right.
Madam Chair, could I respond, please?
Yes, Commissioner Gibbs.
And I'll be brief. I do agree with you that there needs to be East Durham needs to be dealt with in a more comprehensive way. At the outset, I want to get the matter of Edgemont in the conversation from the very absolute beginning, because they are two absolutely different areas, historically, presently, any otherwise. And that's going to be one of the issues that's going to need to be covered, because I do not want Edgemont to be lost. And maybe in our January meeting, if could we have some kind of, well, this was, could I recognize Mel, if you, I didn't get everything you said. What was your idea about a January meeting?
I think what we need to do is those commissioners that are willing to work on a project like this to take to council. If we can get together and come up with some wording that make it clear. You know, Edgemont, those neighborhoods are already in Northeast Central Durham. The city has already have it's already in a 120 block area. The focus for new development is there, right? So all we have to do is get that map and have something that we can pass for our county commissioners to vote on. And if we can do that in 30 days, and I think we can, let's get it done.
Let me just make one comment, and since staff is standing here, is there an appropriate process? I hear this going back and forth. Is there an appropriate process for this recommendation to be made?
The appropriate process would be for you all to vote on an official recommendation to the planning department of what your ask would be for work program consideration. What will happen to that is we will package that along with things we may hear from other boards, some requests that we've heard independently from specific city council members, and we'll package all of those options together to take to Joint City-County Planning Committee, where there will be a discussion about work program priorities for next year. And that will generate the draft work program for next year.
So thank you. Recognize Commissioner Harris had a comment.
You need to finish this first before you go to announcements.
Well, I heard that as a recommendation for how the process would work. So my next question is going to be, is that something that we want to do?
Madam Chair, the motion I am going to make is a procedural one, is that we place this on our agenda for January, because, I mean, everybody here is caught off guard, because I came with a few notes scattered on the margins of a piece of paper. We're not ready, I don't think, to adopt any kind of resolution. But I would like to put it on our January agenda so that we can talk about it. And at that time, maybe I can bring a 100 words and that makes a little bit more comprehensive sense, and people will have an opportunity to know what to respond to.
I would agree with that too.
The chair recognizes Commissioner Busby.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would agree as well. I guess just the one question for staff is, do you need, I know the Joint City-County Planning Committee is meeting in January. Is this on their January agenda, or if we deal with this in January, that's still proper timing for this to move through the process?
Yeah, this will not be on their January agenda. We may have some informal conversation, but the most likely the official item will go to them in February. I had asked as part of, in conjunction with the budget request by January 6th, work program requests were also requested by then, so that staff has time to digest and prep our item for the February Joint City County. However, since you're meeting just a few days beyond that, I would be amenable to allowing you all a few extra days to get me that.
Great. Given the hour, I think that I agree with Commissioner Miller. Let's put this on the January meeting. Thank you.
So I need a motion to move the Planning Department work program to the January meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Miller and Brown.
Okay. Motion by Commissioner Miller and second by Commissioner, who was it?
Brian.
That we move the planning work program to the January project to the January meeting. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed, ayes have it. Announcements.
Okay. You want to tell us what's next month? Nothing, I hope.
You know, honestly, with Grace out, I'm not 100% sure what we have cooked up. Two cases. I'm getting the universal two-case sign from Cobb.
What are they?
Two cases.
Two zoning cases, one of them with a plan amendment. Do you remember off the top of your head what they are?
One of them is 4,000 Van U. I don't remember what that one is.
Okay. One of them is 4,000 Danube, and the other one, we don't remember. But we can certainly... No, Northborough Religion. Okay. Madam Chair, if I might One additional announcement, the planning director, Steve Medlin, for those of you that don't know, is retiring effective December 30th. There is a reception in his honor here in City Hall this Thursday at 3:00 in the committee room. You all are invited if you're available to join us, but he has graciously served the city and the county for more than 30 years, and he will be missed.
Who will be interim director?
I will be the interim director.
Okay.
So, Madam Chair, along those same lines, Steve Medlin is retiring, and the city and county has employed the same agency that the city employed to get our new chief of police. And I have been asked to serve on that committee, and if you guys have any expectation what you would like in the next director for the planning department, if you would submit, you know, me an email or drop me a note, and we can take that forward to this agency that's going to do the search for the new director for the planning department for the city of Durham.
Madam Chairman, may I?
Yes, please. Commissioner Miller.
Given the news that we've just received, I move that the Planning Commission adopt a resolution of appreciation and thanks to Mr. Medlin for his career in planning here in the city of Durham and also, well, the city and county of Durham, that we go ahead and adopt it now, even though that we might draw the paperwork up and present it later.
Second. It has been moved and properly second that will have a motion to present a resolution for our retiring planning director, Steve Medling. So I have a motion by Commissioner Miller and a second by Commissioner Freeman that we provide a resolution for the occasion. Details to be designed. All in favor of this motion, let it be known by the usual sign of aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Thank you.
Madam Chair, I had a question for you, Grace. You mentioned this reception.
Sarah.
Sarah, sorry. You mentioned the reception. What time?
3:00.
3:00. Thank you.
3:00. This Thursday.
Right here?
No, committee room upstairs.
Very good comments from the county commissioners and just about everybody else on the staff. He was very well recognized last night.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Hearing none, motion to adjourn.